Hello, everybody. Welcome. Welcome to the Exhibiting the Interface Symposium, which is connected to the Interface Experience exhibition down the street. If you haven't gone there yet, I hope you get a chance to. It's been a long labor of love for a long time of my own and a lot of other people, and we think it turned out great. So today is to talk a little bit about the challenges of working with computing technology and the ways that you can get things into the gallery. And I'll want to talk more about specifics of that. Before I get into that, I wanted to thank some people who make these symposia, these gallery shows, and make the BGC possible. The first is Director Susan Weber, who is our founder and who provides a lot of leadership intellectually and programmatically for the type of work we can do. Facilitates the amazing gallery work that we are able to do that really enhances the academic aspects of our institution. Dean Peter Miller and Gallery Director Nina Stritzler-Levine, who shepherd all those projects through their very challenging intellectual, practical, and experiential levels, and who have been great guidance for me in this project. They both came to me separately to do this gallery show and charged me, who I'm the Kim and Karamita, both the assistant professor and director of the Digital Media Lab here. So we think a lot about how technology influences the work we do here, and this gallery show and the symposium are a lot about asking those questions in both our academic and museum practice. I also wanted to thank Dean Elena Simon and Lena Block from our academic programs, who spent a ton of time organizing the symposium, and our art department, who does the fabulous graphics you'll see on the signs and our screens and on the websites. The facility staff for getting the seating together, and also the faculty that have always been great ears to talk to about projects and structure these symposium in interesting intellectual ways. Before I get to the specifics of the Interface Experience exhibition that this symposium is connected to, I wanted to talk about our Focus Gallery project and how it sets the stage for a different way of thinking about academic programs and the research we do here at the Bard Graduate Center. As someone who does a lot of digital work, I've found that it's a challenge to get some academic realms to do practice-based, process-oriented thinking. And that's really the type of work that works well with digital material, because you need teams, you need a lot of people with different types of insights to do the kind of broad spectrum of intellectual, procedural, technical work that digital projects require. And what's been a convenient thing at the BGC is that we have this exhibition space, this place where you have to do practice-based, process-oriented work with a large staff of people in order to fill a museum, gallery, or many floors of a space with both the artifacts and all the intellectual structure around those objects to make a cohesive argument and tell a story. And the Focus Gallery is an intentional experimental project that really engages with those aspects full on. And it's been a place where we take the traditional research that we do in the classroom and put it into object-based exhibition style practice. And they're usually projects that take place over a couple of courses with students involved. One usually is a survey of the information, gathering a checklist. The second course more specifically oriented to thinking about design, the positioning of the objects, and often prototyping digital interactives that will go along with the project. So this Focus Gallery project has been a large part of the institution since we expanded into the building that you're currently sitting into since 2009. And it provides a unique platform for different types of projects. We've had a project on Christmas cards in mid-century America. We had a project on Mandelbrot sets and chaos theory. We had a project on 19th century printmaking in New York City. And now we have my project, which is on interface experiences and personal computing for the last 40 years. And each of those projects has facilitated an intellectual experimentality as well as a spatial and in many cases digital experimentality, which are, I think, unique in compared to most institutional work going on either in academic institutions or museums. And it's provided a really good platform for new ways of thinking at the BGC. And that's led to the project that I have been able to do here, the Interface Experience. And as I mentioned before, the dean and the gallery director both came to me and charged me with doing a project that not only brought a new set of material, computing and digital, into the gallery, but also to challenge the structure of museology. And when you get a chance to go down the street, you'll see that all the objects in the space are touchable, they're usable. They're also relics of personal use. We bought all of them on eBay for both cost reasons and also because they are objects that people had. And five of the devices, the Commodore 64, the Macintosh Plus, the Palm Pilot, the iPad, and the Kinect are usable so that you can actually experience the interface. You're not just looking at an object or touching it, but you're going through that interactive connection of hardware, software, and person in a single kind of unified system, which is what the interface is. The idea of getting people to use original objects, to touch them, and to create custom applications for those objects as part of the exhibition and not just as interpretive material is really outside the norms of most museological practice. And that was something I wanted to do and something that I felt that this set of objects necessitated. And in an activist sense, I kind of think of like, what do the objects we put on display necessitate for our fullest understanding, and how should the museum respond to that rather than working within a preset set of traditional museological standards to approach to the objects. With all of that said, the idea for this symposium was to bring some of those stories outside of the BGC and also from the project out to start a bigger conversation about the challenge of exhibiting interface and the newness that computers bring into the historical record. I've been to a couple of museums, the Museum of Modern Art, and also the Computer History Museum, where computers sit back in a corner. They're behind a piece of plastic or glass, and they're turned off, they're dead. I've seen the Macintosh without its mouse or keyboard, which kind of makes it an idealized aesthetic object rather than this really complex part of our social history. The Computer History Museum, which is the history of computers museum, you know, there isn't much interactivity, and they have a lot of objects, but they're also off, they're turned off. They're kind of telling a history of the objects without allowing the people to work through how it might have been at different periods. You know, what was it like to use a Cray computer? It's this fabulous, tall, beautiful supercomputer with benches you could sit on, but what was the terminal experience? How is it so different from what we expect from our mobile devices and our computers today? But that's a big challenge, and you run into a lot of obstacles. So to talk today, we have Deborah Douglas from MIT, whose full bio I'll give in a second, and Jonathan Dahan, who is our developer of the interactives, to talk about what we do with technology in museum spaces and how we answer some of those questions, both from kind of a historical curatorial perspective and also from the nuts and bolts in the process of making the applications perspective. So we're going to hear from the two of them, and we'll get to ask some questions of them initially. Then we're going to take a break, and then we also have with us Coven Smith from the Blanton Museum and Jennifer Foley from the Cleveland Museum of Art, who are going to be here tomorrow for the second part of this symposium, which is about digital interpretation. They're going to join us for a panel session, and the five of us will talk a little bit about all the things we'll bring up in the first part of the symposium, and then take more of your questions. So to move on, I'm going to introduce Deborah Douglas. Deborah G. Douglas is Director of Collections and Curator of Science and Technology at the MIT Museum, as well as Research Associate with the MIT Program in Science, Technology, and Society. She is a graduate of Wellesley College and the University of Pennsylvania, and as Director of Collections, she manages one of the most diverse university museum collections in the world. In her curatorial role, she oversees the museum's extensive science and technology collections, works with scholars and researchers interested in the history of technology and science, and coordinates programs with the faculty and staff of the Institute. Deborah has also held positions at the National Air and Space Museum, the NASA Langley Research Center, the Chemical Heritage Foundation, and taught her class at Old Dominion University, MIT. She has curated more than 30 exhibitions on a wide variety of science and technology topics, written or contributed to 3 books and more than 30 articles and reviews, produced 24 video shorts, and overseen several major preservation and conservation projects. Deborah?
Something like this. You said a bunch of interesting things at the SHOT conference. I think it would be great if you would come and talk to us. That's enormously flattering, so thank you. But a very open-ended invitation. And so today I thought, well, I'm going to think about this subject through the lens. And so I've titled this Tech's Museum because for many years that was the nickname for MIT, was Tech. And Museum Tech to indicate my exploration of the ways in which we use technology to tell stories in our facility. And I don't want to give the impression that I view myself as an expert. I actually think there are many people in this room who are actually expert in many aspects of this task. So what I hope to be is a conversation starter, to stimulate and share some thoughts, ideas with you, and to gain insights from you. I am probably, though, the expert on MIT in this room. And so the first part of my presentation, I'm going to walk you through a little bit of history about MIT and its relationship with telling technology stories. And then we'll shift more specifically into a presentation about the ways in which we incorporate technology into the museum. So that's a little overview of this presentation. And I want to take you back to the mid-19th century. And say that MIT began as a dream of a man by the name of William Barton Rogers. He was a geology professor at the University of Virginia who began in the 1830s and 1840s to perceive a need for a new kind of educational institution. He'd been commissioned by the state of Virginia to conduct a geological survey of Virginia, and he had a terrible time finding the right people to hire. Because if they were good in the field, they had no knowledge of geology, they had no knowledge of the overall principles, and if they were knowledgeable in those areas, they had no idea how to conduct a survey or survive. So he felt that the industrializing world needed a new kind of person, one that could combine skills and smarts. And he wrote his first vision in 1848 to his brother who was living in Boston. He relocated to Boston. And in the objects and plans for the Institute, there was a very elaborate statement about what this new education would embrace. And I quote here a line from that object and plan, and it said, in view of this recognized connection between industrial progress and an enlarged acquaintance with the objects and phenomena of nature and with the physical laws, we find that the most enlightened communities of Europe have endeavored to provide for the practical cooperation of education and the arts by the establishment of museums, society, and colleges of technology. And so what MIT was, in the first instance, was a vision to embrace all three activities. And that led to a lengthy section about the museum that it was going to embrace. And I share with you three excerpts. It's a really long treatment, actually, on what the museum was. But three important excerpts here from the principles. In the first instance, the number one goal of a museum ought to be instruction, not just accumulating stuff, but teaching. Number two, it was not that objects were not enough, that mere possession of objects, the mere display of them, they had no power unto themselves. And the third observation he made that said here, the practical teaching and the real suggestiveness of a museum is almost wholly dependent on the clear and rational arrangement of its parts and the leading ideas which rule their classification. In other words, success will be a function of how well conceptualized and executed and organized this museum is. So there's a very interesting pedagogy, and I bring that back, or want to point it out to you, because it's not dissimilar from your ambitions with this exhibition. A lot has happened in the last 150 years to give us the modern science center that we have, and which is very different from this statement of principles. Let me tell you that, so April 10th, 1861, this whole enterprise finally was approved. We were incorporated by the state legislature of Massachusetts, and in this section, this is the actual document on the right, and on the right here it says, for the purposes of instituting and maintaining a society for the art, a museum of art, and a school of industrial science, and aiding generally by suitable means, and so forth. Now, the use of the word art is really important. It's called the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, but this is one of the first times this word was used. Technology was a very new word, begun in the 1829, 1830s, and people didn't know what it meant. Technology was a very vague, ephemeral term. And so the reason that we're talking about arts, people understood the industrial arts. They understood the practical arts. And you see the application, practical application of science in connection with arts, agriculture, manufactures, and commerce. That's what we called, or would MIT would come to represent, is technology. That's what people would say technology is. Now, we're in a world today when we say technology, what does it mean? When you say technology to your students, what do they mean? What comes to mind?
Computers.
It's computers, 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 computers. And if you say, well, is a refrigerator technology? Yeah, yes.
A knife.
Is a bicycle technology? I mean, they come, but it's all of you who teach these classes know how painful this is to get people to move off of the computer. This was not the case in 1861. Now, what happens April
12th,
1861? Fort Sumter. Firing on Fort Sumter.
Guns are technology.
Yes, they are technologies, but it was not good for founding a new institute, because all we had was an incorporation charter. We had no money, no building, no teachers, no students. We certainly weren't going to have students. So, in fact, we are just right now at the 150th anniversary of starting to teach students. That began in 1865. So, the consequence of that delay was, and the fact that even though people were very enthusiastic about this new school and this new proposal, it was hard to raise money in the middle of a war. And so the Society of the Arts, the museum pieces, they were de-emphasized, with the focus being on creating this college, this school building. So we don't build a grand new museum, even though we have lots of elaborate plans. The closest we get, to be honest, in the 19th century, are these rooms set aside by departments. This is the civil engineering room. They call them museums, but they're not open to the public. They're really displays laid out. In the lower right-hand corner is a stereo card of the architectural museum, such that it was, which is really the collection of decorative arts and sculptural forms that had been accumulated. These were used for instruction, but they were not presented to the general public for their edification. What they did do, though, is start the Society of the Arts. So about once a week, really interesting people came to MIT to give talks on the cutting-edge science of the day. So this was about, this is Edward Muybridge, for example, comes to talk about his new study on horses in motion. He makes a presentation. Alexander Graham Bell introduces telephony at MIT in these public lectures. The first X-ray in Boston were demonstrated here at MIT, and then they collaborated with the doctors from Mass General to become the first institution to use X-rays in the hospital for the diagnosis of injury and to a poor fellow with a knife blade stuck in his back. So there was public outreach. I guess this is the analog to Nova or the Discovery Channel going on, but it creates a science-interested, technology-oriented community in public. Very important idea of engaging the public. But some of you, all of this activity was taking place in Boston at Copley Square, and they basically, the city of Boston grew up around the Institute. So in 1860, the population of Boston was 177,000. By 1900, the population was 677,000. The streets were all dug up. They were putting that first subway line in, through the America's first subway and so forth. The place was a mess, and so there was no room to grow. Copley Square was the sort of ground zero for the Athens of America. It's not just MIT, it's the Harvard Medical School, the Museum of Fine Arts, Trinity Church, Old South Church, the Boston Public Library. It's all there, concentrated. So it's a very exciting, interesting place, but no place to grow and move. So they look across the river to this newly filled land on the other side of the Charles, and decide that that will be the place to build what was termed the Great White City. To send a message, the challenge to the architect William Wells Bosworth was to build a place like no other in the world, to make an architectural statement that science and technology were part of modern life and that you should never forget it. So this building is created, and they open it in June of 1916 with this multi-day extravaganza for the public. So this is the original 1903 Wright Flyer. It was the first time it was displayed on in public, brought to MIT. It's probably the reason that it's available to now preserve in the Smithsonian in Washington, because Orville opened up the crates, which had all been submerged in the Dayton floods a few years earlier, discovered that all the wood, the fabric, everything had deteriorated. So they did all the restoration, recovered it, and made it possible for this display as part of the opening, open house event at MIT for this dedication. But that wasn't the only demonstration going on. They had pageants. It's a pageant of progress. So, you know, this is like technology's Oberammergau that they did. It was a four-hour extravaganza with 1,700 costumed undergraduates, a band, a light show, and orchestra. And they came in over hours and they reenacted progress. And so they start with the discovery of fire. But what do you suppose the culminating moment in progress is? Oh, come on, our ego is so great, it was the founding of MIT. In this. And so, you know, so there's an artistic expression. They had all the ribbon cutting, stone laying, ceremony stuff, but they concluded with a banquet at Symphony Hall, which featured what was called the telephone banquet. Now, in 1915, the first transcontinental telephone call is made. This is less than a year later, in June of 1916, that they hook up a transcontinental call with all the MIT clubs all around the country. Wow. So, if you're looking up here, I think this is, trying to read here which club this one is. Akron, Ohio, is club. And all the people, every single person there has a little receiver. He's hooked in to listening to the speeches here on in Symphony Hall in Boston. And so this is the circuit diagram of this. That's a phenomenal feat, if you think about orchestrating that and pulling this off. And so everybody could listen in to Orville Wright and Alexander Graham Bell and Michael Poopen from Columbia and, you know, all say great things. And they had these speeches and they raised money and they cheered tech and, you know, it was sort of the culminating moment. But if you think about this technology moment, this was showing off. And of course, Vail was an MIT alumnus, so he is trying to get his company to show off what we can do, how we can do it, and the place of the educational institution. So there's it's a really remarkable occasion. MIT does finally build its first museum in 1922 when it creates the Hart Nautical Gallery. It's the first purpose-built museum space at MIT. But it's a product of the 19th century. They're trying to say that the fundamental way in which you teach people to be engineers is that you have to set before them models, drawings, plans, and that by the study and scrutiny of those things, if you could draw the machine, then you understood it. This world, in 1922, this is being planned by all the faculty, senior faculty members who were educated in the late 19th century. Now, their younger colleagues must have thought this was crazy, because this was a brave new world of mathematics. The slide rule, the mathematical analysis was beginning to take over engineering. So this becomes, instead of what they thought was their learning lab, this is their equivalent. They thought they were building your lab. But those of you that maintain digital labs, this is what they thought they were making, a cutting-edge pedagogical space. You know, when in fact, it becomes a reliquary very quickly. By the way, it's still popular, still there. They did have to put glass cases over the ship models and lock the cabinets, which were filled underneath with plans, because, quote unquote, in the annual report, the urchins of Cambridge were coming in and helping themselves to this. So our first attempt at public accessibility had to be, you know, some controls had to be imposed on this. But the open house was still our big thing. After World War II in 1945, we had a Victory in Science exhibition. 75,000 people came, and we know that number to be true because you had to have bought or buy at that time a war bond in order to gain admission to this display that featured everything from a flotilla of airplanes, of ships, flyovers, radar, flame-throwing tanks. Every conceivable kind of technology was on display, and people flocked to this. So the sense of the Wizard's War was made real and made tangible to the general public. And then hereafter, we had annual open houses to show off the work of the Institute. In 1949, shortly after the Soviet Union announced its successful explosion of their first atomic bomb, MIT organized an event called the Mid-Century Convocation to speak about the role of science, technology, and society. And this is Boston Garden, and Winston Churchill was the keynote speaker. His speech given at that time was considered sort of second only to his Iron Curtain speech. And in terms of public policy significance and international relations. But he made an interesting point at the side, which was that science and technology was vital to the defense of democracy. But if you didn't know why you were defending democracy, you know, that you would surely fall prey to communism and the forces of evil. And of fascism and the like. So he felt that the solution was the humanities. And in fact, many people felt that. So all of you humanities types, take heed. here. This is a great message. In the 50s, they used it to say, how do you protect against the evils of communism and fascism? You need to take history. You need to study the arts. You're all in this business. Get with it now, you know, if you're going to save the world from its failings, you need history classes. Then MIT got, you know, really full of itself. It sent its own spokespeople to the moon, for example. This is Buzz Aldrin on the right and Charles Stark Draper, who led the development of the Apollo guidance computer system on the right. But at the same time, in 69, the world is disintegrating. And people don't view technology as always wonderful. There's a sense that there's some consequences, that they could be positive and negative. And so there was, MIT had the same protests that were present elsewhere at the Institute. So this is the same iLab that put, you know, from this slide here. This is, you know, within months of that achievement. That was July, this is November. You see the antipathy and anger being directed towards the lab and its contributions to the military-industrial university complex. So it's at this moment that the MIT Museum is created, 1971, as a function of an outcome of the inauguration of President Jerry Wiesner. And they had a little photographic exhibit. People thought that was great fun. They decided to maybe have an exhibition that featured some collections. And on the second floor of this building behind Warren Siemens, who was the humanities administrator who had been asked to create these first two exhibitions, is where they call it the furniture storage facility of MIT. And that's where they found old furniture, portraits, busts of William Barton Rogers and so forth. So they decided that's where we're going to locate the museum. This building was built by General Radio. So GenRad, for those of you, is there anyone old enough in this room to know who GenRad is? Probably not. They were kind of trying to think about who the analog is today in modern electronic supply. But in any case, we come into this building, which had been on the building on the right, had been used to test the gyroscopes for the ICBMs and Apollo program. On the right was the furniture storage. So that's us. Now, we set up the problem for today. We fit ourselves into an old warehouse. The square marked P is where MIT, about just a year ago, proposed moving the museum. And this area is Kendall Square. And this shaded, all these building, gray buildings with numbers and the like, are existing buildings, almost all of which are part of the MIT campus. And there's been a lot of activity, you know, the Biogens and Genzymes and Novartis's and Millennium and all. They're all wanting to be in this area. So the real estate is enormously valuable. And so this area, R, P, M, and N, are all slated, excuse me, P, N, and M, are all slated to be new commercial buildings. It's really profitable. And to give you a sense of that profit, the equivalent rent, the projected annual rent from those three buildings would be as if MIT added $6 billion to its endowment of $11 billion. So the stakes are very high for those buildings. The city of Cambridge, however, is really concerned that it not turn into some kind of sterile office park, where the workers all come in at 7, 8 in the morning, and then they all go home at 5 and 6 and 7 in the afternoon. They want a vibrant community and street life. That's where the museum comes in. We are a bargaining chip between the people with the permits and the people who want to pocket the cash. It's couched in fancy languages about being a new gateway for the Institute, because people arrive at Kendall Square. Anyone gotten, tried to go to MIT, and you get off on the T-stop, Kendall, MIT, and you think, well, where am I? Like, I have no idea. Where am I? I don't understand. It's almost impossible to orient yourself from this location. So that's, you know, that's the space. But it gives us the opportunity to completely rethink the museum and how to do that. And so that presents for us a number of interesting challenges. Now, we have five main collections. And they're not organized in that rational way that Roger suggested in that original part. We're kind of like a pudding stone, you know, those rocks where you see the sedimentary rock around the side, but you still see the whole boulders embedded in the rock. That's kind of like us. So we have the Hart Nautical Collections. We have the Architecture and Design Collections. We have the Holography Collection, which is the old New York Museum of Holography. Lock, Stock, and Barrel was migrated to MIT. We have the Science and Technology Collections, and we have the General Collection. So for me, when I was hired in 99, it was, if it's not a boat, a building, a beaver, or a hologram, well, then I did it. So this is not, I don't want to say this is a clear, rational organizing principle, but nonetheless, here we are. So holography is this amazingly interesting technology. You know, it's a Cold War technology that, even though they've stopped making the film like 20 years ago, people still think of it as, oh, it says future. It's a technology that's perpetually identified with the future. Spatial imaging, 3D imaging. It's the most complicated of our artifacts to display. Holograms are incredibly fussy. They only show up if you shine the light or the laser at exactly the right angle, in exactly the right position, and you, the viewer, stand in exactly the right place and move just exactly the right way. So the interface, the personal interface here, is incredibly demanding for these holograms. If you put them at, you know, 60 inches, which is what museums, you know, like to do for their paintings and so forth, their sight line, you notice here, you know, that I'm 6'4", so it's right at my eyeball level. If you're tall, like you guys, you have to scoop down. You know, if you're short, if you're a kid, mom and dad's gonna hold you up. If you put them down too low for somebody in a wheelchair, you know, to see, then everybody else can't see them. It's a very, very complicated technology to display. We have the world's most extensive collection of holograms, and that's one of the challenges. How do you put this on display? It needs all sorts of environmental controls. It's very demanding. So then on the other extreme, we have objects that those of you that have been to our museum know are wildly popular, which are these. This is one example of Arthur Ganson's kinetic sculptures. And Ganson is very interesting as an artist because he is not attempting to find art. He's not he doesn't work with found art. In other words, he spent time as an artist in residence at MIT wandering around the departments talking with people. What do you do? How do you do it? And then it's as if he got a whole bunch of new tools in his toolbox and he went and he created these pieces. They resonate very deeply with our community because he has picked up on code words. We talked about this at lunch, about the Nintendo. Why does Nintendo get featured at the museums? Because it makes cultural references that the art historians and the curators recognize and pick up. Why is Arthur Ganson popular as a kinetic sculptor? Because he makes cultural references that the engineers pick up and seize on. It's a very interesting lesson about interface to be held in that is not just the tangible interface, but in fact, the cultural interface that these objects may represent. Now, we do brass and glass exhibits. Only our Our brass is really more usually aluminum. Robots are to science museums what dinosaurs are to natural history museums. We are unashamed about our exploitation of robotics. In part, we feel some legitimacy in doing this because really important work in artificial intelligence and robotics has been done at MIT. So we, under the aegis of education and history and preservation, you know, we present this. But it's shameless. It's shameless. Now, every visitor critique of our museum says, why don't the robots work? Make your robots work. Well, you know, I used to answer, if we were Disney World, you know, we could make them work. Because that implies, oh, we would have, you know, tens of thousands of dollars per square foot to engineer these things. But the honest truth is, Kismet doesn't work because Kismet barely worked, ever. Most of the robots built in graduate school and in engineering barely work. 10, 20 minutes, enough to shoot a video, get your thesis out the door. These are not the assembly line robots of Ford. Kismet, when it came to the museum, had 20 different computers hooked up to it. Several of which, we got it basically because three of them were so obsolete they couldn't make them work anymore. So let's assume though we had Jonathan and we could make them work again. That's assuming we had them, but we don't have the mainframes. We don't have the whole complicated ecology of graduate students that sustained and nurtured these things to keep them running. And again, they were done for research, so they're not robust platforms. Very interesting challenge then in terms of design. Our fantasies have been, honestly, can you develop intentional, build robots that teach concepts, that make visual and visible concepts, which then people could play with. So that's, when we get our $1 million, maybe in our new fancy museum, we'll do something like that. We've also experimented with other kinds of technologies and living organisms. The most demanding, well not the most, but one of the most demanding years of my life was the year I had to keep 100 zebrafish alive. You know, the Brits call their curators keepers. And
keepers of a fish.
Yes, so zookeepers are the only, you know, version in the United States that we still have. I can tell you, I do not aspire to be a zookeeper. You know, because in part of your gallery planning, you know, Kimon talked about, I had to teach people how to touch stuff at a museum exhibit. We have to instruct them in how to do this. Well, I had to plan, what happens if the animal rights activists come in and decide to protest the display of these animals? What's our contingency plan for that? What is, how do you keep them open? Dead fish are bad for business. People do not want to see floaters. It's very disturbing. It's more disturbing than a, this exhibit is out of order. No fooling. So you have to keep this whole bench system, this, you know, thing that was meant for behind the scenes with PhD technicians who normally keep it running. How do we keep this running in full view? How do you keep it working? How do you keep the tanks clean, the fish fed, you know, all of those things? It turns out they need 24/7 care. And so I was never so grateful at the end of that year when we were done with that project. I also learned something really important. We throw out words in the science museum business. Lab. How many of you have a little, you're a digital media lab, for example. Well, when you deal with live organisms, you'd never want to use that word. We never wanted to say, why? Because that invokes, then we would have to have inspections by all of the, you know, the,
IRB.
We have to have all kinds of safety inspections. We have to have rulings about health. We have to, I mean, in other words, do we have consent forms Do we have, I mean, all sorts of things. You never want to say you're conducting an experiment or lab. I mean, it's like those of you that have done oral histories, you know, and you have to get consent forms for your work. It's very bizarre to go to people and say, well, I'm going to interview about race and MIT, and they have to, they have a form that says, this conversation might cause death.
Really?
So your vocabulary, the interface, one of the complexities about showing certain kinds of technologies is that you, it's not just your world that you're interacting with. So then, MIT, home of the media laboratory. Oh, you must do lots of things with the media laboratory. I'd love to do lots of things with the media laboratory. They are like on their own time zone. And their budgets are different, but this is a project we did with Judith Donath on, it's called Connections, and she was exploring identity in the digital realm. And so these were, how do you create data portraits of yourselves? You know, when you think of an art museum portrait, you're thinking of, you know, oils or paint or pen and ink applied to a canvas, and there's some reflection. We know how to interpret those. And what is your data portrait if you type in your name? So it was wildly popular. You type in a name, and up would come, it would search through all the web, and then up would come this profile, like how many of the references were militaristic, and how many were political, and how many were economic. You could see this name charted out. Here's where I discovered, like, the child laws, okay? You can't have a minor disclose their name without their parents' permission on the line. So we had to create vocabulary that says type a name, not your name. And we kind of got dispensation because we were an educational institution, so, but there are state laws and regulations about recording. So the exhibit recorded ambient noise and then projected images of you walking among these towers, back on the towers, but it occurred later, and it records snippings of ambient conversation. It turns out you can, in Massachusetts, you can videotape people without their consent, but you cannot audiotape without their consent. Wow. So we had to create, I had to learn how to create tape marks on the floor and then have warning lines say, if you step over this tape line, you are giving consent to have your conversations recorded. And so the challenges, again, of presenting this, you know, this is an art installation. You think all about these high-minded intellectual ideas, but it comes down to the environments around you constraining you. Now, every Friday after Thanksgiving, we run an event called FAT, or Friday After Thanksgiving, which is a giant chain reaction led by Arthur Ganson. People bring, there's usually about 60 or 70 links. They all bring your link together, which is like the size of this table, and it has to start with the pull of a string and end with the pull of a string, but what it does in between is entirely up to you. And then about 2 o'clock in the afternoon, after spending all morning cooking these things up, they run the whole Rube Goldberg contraption. This is like wildly popular.
Wow.
People.
I want to do that.
Yes. Well, you can. You can sign up to build a link and join us Friday after Thanksgiving, 2015. So it's part art installation, part maker, part creative. Very, very successful as an event. So you're thinking about this, and we're now in our 17th year, so this even predates some of the hype and buzz around maker spaces. Now, you don't have to go high tech. It turns out one of our most popular exhibitions was very simply designed. It's on slide rules. And we had a bucket with slide rules that we put there out, and we had a volunteer who on weekends sat around and said, how do you use a slide rule? People loved it. They write all sorts of favorable things. It's, in terms of exhibit design, there's nothing special about it. There's nothing artistically interesting. But they love knowing antiquarian skills. And with young kids, it was all branding. I'd say, well, what's this? I said, it's a green calculator. Come again? Well, I said, well, see, it's made of renewable materials. It doesn't use any electricity or batteries, it's portable, you can carry it anywhere. You know, and look, you can do these things, you can multiply, divide, find square roots, signs, you know. You got some of these specialty things, you can determine the effects of a nuclear bomb, you know, on it. And they're like, oh, that's so cool. So sometimes retro is cool, and I think that's part of the appeal in this exhibit is going back and relearning certain skills that maybe you once had, or teaching people about it, sharing. It would be very interesting to see how many adults share, or with people of a certain age, share with younger people. You know, well, that's how I did it. Now, access behind the scenes is really limited to this. It's really constrained. You make appointments, you come in, the curator, my colleague Kurt Hasselbeck on the right, brings out, you know, all of his 18,000 ship plans and, you know, 100,000 photographs, and people see this very small business. And as you notice that there's changes here, the documentary film world, this is a PBS setup for an interview in our Robots and Beyond gallery, and it's very, things are changing when you go from PBS to YouTube. So we have visitors coming in and they're holding up their phones like this and taking video, and that's appearing on the screen. So this old paradigm, if you will, of using the collections and making them more publicly accessible, it's very expensive, very tedious, very slow. Historical reenactment has moved from the Civil War reenactors in costume to something rather different. This is an experiment we did a year and a half ago with the fellow on the right, just to the right of the camera, Jorge Otero Palias, who teaches at Columbia in historic preservation. Jorge wanted to recreate Edgerton's bullet through the apple. So we actually worked. That's the original rifle. It's in our collection. We use the original flashes. We use the original camera. We had to figure out how to set it up. Now, the purpose of this was not to learn Edgerton's techniques, although we did learn a lot about Edgerton's techniques. But rather, Jorge was interested and inspired by his architectural history training at MIT and Gideon's time and space. And what he wanted to do was, can we, by doing this, reenacting this experiment, can we learn about a certain period of time and cultural concepts of time and space that were changed by the conduct of this experiment, by these original photographs. So that's a different sort of reenactment. This is not simply trying to replicate or restore something. This is trying to understand a cultural phenomenon. Now, we have somebody from Cleveland, so you should recognize your picture here up online. Our visitors are changing. They come in with, like, Batman, you know, with utility belts of smartphones and tablets and all sorts of gadgets, right, you know, attached to themselves. And so the folks at the Cooper Hewitt, at Cleveland, you know, every place except the MIT Museum, is doing these amazing things to play with these new technologies, find new ways to interact with them. That's only accelerating. Those trends are only going to accelerate. And they mean, for example, that it's not just, we're moving beyond the acoustic guide and the little iPods that people used to tell, which is, how can the curator data dump more on you? They wouldn't let me put more than 100 words on that label. So I'm going to give you 3 hours of iPod commentary on this, because, and I'm going to link you in to every brochure, bulletin, you know, cool thing that I found on this, you know, fact, because God forbid that you actually look at it. You know, and this paradigm is shifting before our eyes. So we have a few crude gestures here at the museum, but I have to say, in comparison to Cleveland, our gestures at interacting with technology are quite primitive. They're things like touch a plasma globe. Now, it's true. Bill Parker invented it as an undergraduate at MIT. It's a pretty cool story. And we have, here's a video of the TXO entering sound. So you at least get the auditory sounds of the computer. You can hear it and see it, but it's very simple, you know, little screen added here. And, Space War, that's another game played here and invented here in the PDP-1. And we've put up, like other people, you know, a little screen where you could play, you know, an emulation version of Space War. We've done it with Scratch, we've done it with lots of the computer programs. This is sort of basic. We've worked with the OLPC folks when they wanted to prototype concepts or play with them. They had been developing concepts. They would come over to the museum for a series of Saturday afternoons, and they would bring new computers. They just played them, put them out, and watch kids see if they could figure them out, play with those versions. So that's a little bit different from interactive, you know, the earlier, but still pretty basic on this. So, and now we've recently, this is our most recent exhibit called Images of Discovery, and this is an attempt to figure out how can we make interactives that feel more adult. So the arcade game buttons that every science center has learned are the only ways to keep your exhibits functioning for long periods of time and not having someone have to, you know, a gallery fix-it person live there permanently. You know, how can we dress that up? The problem is that the images, every science center, they say, what's the difference between your museum and the Museum of Science in Boston? I say 11 inches. What? Huh? Well, because the average plinth height in a museum when your target audience is 9 is 19 to 25 inches high. And the average plinth height for a museum that views adults as its target audience is 29 to 36 inches. So you know when you walk into a museum right away if you're the target audience. You know it because is the information presented at your kneecaps or at your waist? So, you know, how do we do this? So this is Edgerton's milk drop experiment, and you can, you know, fiddle with this. You press the button, you can take the picture with your eye. With the iPad, and you can send this off. We have a Flickr site where, you know, best of visitor pictures get loaded up every few days here. This is very simple. This is not rocket science that we're doing here. This, by the way, is popular. I mean, even in the few weeks that it's been open, people love this. But it's sort of a superficial simulation of the various kinds of experiments that were being conducted. It doesn't ask terribly interesting or serious questions about the work that's being done. It's more preoccupied with the how of science and not the why, what, who, when. All the other interesting questions that make, I think, a successful science and technology museum of the future. So we made a few gestures towards this. There's a course taught during our January winter session on build your own coffee can radar set. Up in the upper right is a radar image of the Alexander Calder Great Sail sculpture on campus. I think the trick we will have is, can you translate that sort of very small microcosm class into a broader experience? It feeds both education, making, teaches something profound about the technology. Now we need to also move beyond the ordinary slow axis of visitors. This is kind of one of our unusual visitors. It's not every day that Lady Gaga comes through to explore your collection, but you've got to move from this sort of one-off, one at a time, into how do you disseminate information online for thousands. So the MOOCs that you see coming to our world here. Now, Vannevar Bush gave us this idea of, he gave us differential analyzers that you see depicted here. He also gave us memex, the notion that computer might aid our memory, might aid our organization. And that's really important here, the images here of digitization. In order to use a computer to aid our memory, we have to have data to be to access. And several of you in informal conversations have pointed out these wonderful repository, digital repositories online, of documents, of drawings, of plans, and the like. I think one of the hugely important things to keep in mind is that this is the commodification of knowledge. Mm-hmm. We're digesting, processing the raw materials of history so that they can be more efficiently and extensively incorporated into the global economy. So, you know, make no mistake about what we're doing here. This is an economic activity. There are, the signs of this are everywhere in terms of the preservation problem. So my first piece of software to preserve is this little software used to sign the 21st century charter that was held when MIT celebrated its 150th anniversary. But the real challenge is not a simple piece of software to record how the people made their digital signatures, because that's not rocket science. The real challenge is, this is the Whitehead Institute, which sequenced about a third of the human genome. How do we preserve that software? And I'm not saying how do we preserve the data. That the federal government has responsibility for that. But how do we preserve the software that the machines, the artifacts of this? How do we take old artifacts, this is the Whirlwind computer, or Claude Shannon's The Seuss, and make those come alive so that they're not just static objects that we care for, but that we understand what they did and how they were used, how they were designed and built. You see, the Media Lab worked with the Harvard Art Museums on an unusual non-invasive conservation project, which with these Rothko murals, which is, can you project the right color pixels on top of the original murals so that when you see them as the original colors, not faded? It's a really interesting trick. So you can see that's what he's holding the card in front here. You see the colors that are being projected onto the murals, which mix with the original colors. Really interesting new technology. The filmmaker Ricky Leacock, who brought cinema verite to the United States, had an expression he called the feeling of being there. And that's, of course, one of the things that we're striving for, is the feeling of being there. It's a new kind of immersive experience. So we've done a few experiments with Google Glass and their design. This is the Microsoft HoloLens, which is an apple in the eye of all of my spatial imaging colleagues who work with our holography collections. Is there some way to create a kind of experience of being in the museum, but maybe being in another museum or playing a game with somebody over here? And I conclude here with a question here I have to ask. Are you a knowledge capitalist or are you a knowledge socialist? Okay? And or let me put it another way. Here's the other instantiation of this. Are you Disney or are you Pelagius? And the reason for making this observation is this, that we have to move beyond this old paradigm that museums are vaults of treasures. Because if we stay in that world, as cultural institutions, we will fail. So, you know, that's why we're digitizing frantically, and then, you know, but I would suggest to you that we need to rethink our paradigm, that we need to think of ourselves more like supermarkets. That maybe that's not the right perfect analog, but nobody goes into a supermarket intimidated, whether they're a great chef or just trying to find some paper towels. you pick up the goods, you try them, you're thinking about possibilities, maybe recipes. You call somebody on the phone. What did I forget? Or do I need, or do we have, what do we have? Think about the all of the transactions and interactions how people have in those supermarket experiences. People carry, that's the cultural knowledge they carry into our museums. And so they're going to expect our stuff to be accessible in those kinds of ways. They want to pick them up, they want to try them out, they want to use them, and they don't necessarily want to be told how to use them. So this is sort of the gloss on socialism, but we have to act like our stuff is, in fact, communal property. And so this you may remember at the beginning with William Barton Rogers. I would say that there's a kind of modern instantiation of this, is that in organizing and conducting the Museum and the Institute, reference should be had rather to the extent of potential engagement with than to the multitude of objects which it might embrace. That a mere miscellaneous collection of objects, however vast, has little power to engage or incite. And the practical teaching and real significance of a museum is almost wholly dependent on the clear and rational arrangements of its part and the leading ideas which create opportunities for use. And so I'll conclude with that set of thoughts to say, well, that's kind of what the world looks like to an overwhelmed curator at the museum, with a sense of trying to appreciate the history of the world in which we live in, what the opportunities are, and a sense that this new world really does present an opportunity to reinvent ourselves. And I hope very much we don't squander it, and so I appeal to you for suggestions, recommendations on how to make that the best it can be. Thank you.
Like I said before, maybe we'll just take a couple of direct questions for Debbie, and then we'll move on to Jonathan. So, but.
I have a comment. It's, I guess, in part intended to be polemical, but I asked myself when you were summarizing, is it the case that the museum shouldn't be the vault? And I'm wondering about this because I think that there are aspects of MIT that are highly elitist and separate from the world at large and need to be for all kinds of reasons. And maybe there are aspects of museum practices, I mean, I throw this out, even in the digital world, even when we live in a time when visitors have certain expectations, that the museum should also be a place of accepted, hermetic solitude and isolation, and not to say that.
I think that's a really great.
And I think that this is an interesting challenge for people in museums dealing with technology and other forms of interpretation, is how do you navigate these? And
I should make one point. I don't think we're giving up our role as stewards of stuff. What I do think is, writers don't make a fetish of word processing software, so I don't think we want to make a fetish of how great we are at storing stuff. I just think that should be taken for granted that museums store and maintain stuff, and that we don't need to fetishize that as the primary activity. So that's one thing. The question of style and approaches, like literary genres, there are contemplative museums, there are expert museums, there are educational infotainment type museums. I have the sense, though, that the consumer. I mean, all the categories are breaking down. Who's the producer? Who's the consumer here? But to the extent that people come to us, they have to pay some money to go through the gate. There's so much competition for their time here, and so many possibilities. They can go to Disney World. They can go to the Red Sox game. They can play soccer, you know, on a Saturday. You know, there's all these, they can go to the MFA, they can walk the Freedom Trail, they can, you know, the amount of things. You could just do laundry, they could lay at home, you know, lay on the couch, they could play, they could be playing video games and interfacing with their computer, you know, all of those things. Why come to the museum? You know, if we're to be a viable center of culture, so I think you have to think very carefully about your market to know what kind of space you are. But in telling the history of MIT, it's always been one of telling a story about the place of science and technology in society. It's been very active in projecting and wanting to have a discourse, to create that discourse. And so I think at our museum, if we're true to our institution, probably will be less contemplative and more engaging. But that's not to say the other choices are invalid, and so your point is well taken. I'm muddling around on an answer there for a really important question, so, yeah.
Do you share visitation numbers and like what is sort of the general data or profile of a
Yeah, so when I came in 99, we had about 20,000 visitors a year. We have about 115,000 visitors a year now. We have another 50,000 who take part in our Cambridge Science Festival activities that occur in the third week of April. The projected space by simply relocating on top of the MBTA would suggest visitation numbers in roughly comparable size spaces of 174,000 to 250,000 a year. So you have a target number of about, right now, about 200,000. To have more than that, we need bigger space because you need more people, more staff, more bathrooms. When Air and Space opened in 76, the projection was 5 million visitors in 76, and then two to three million annually thereafter. That's how many bathrooms, that's how many seats in the cafeteria. You know, everything was designed around those assumptions. They had like 10 million the first year. The numbers spiked up a little bit. It averages 9 to 10, 12 million annually ever since. And so they've had to rebuild all of the infrastructure as a consequence. But that's our numbers, yes. Yeah.
It was a lovely talk. I wondered about to which degree the history of the museum dovetails actually with the history of MIT libraries. Because I've looked at Columbia a little bit at the history of some of their book collections, and one of the things that I was struck by, if I tried to trace provenance, that it seemed at least in New York City there was a very pragmatic Yankee attitude that if new holdings were coming in, that people were clear and that donors knew that there were other institutions in town that did similar related things, and that very specifically, Columbia got certain things for teaching, and other things went as beautiful objects to the Met, for example. So I wondered whether there is some, you know, I was struck by the fact that you have basically a lab component at the origin of the MIT, and then it takes about 60 or 70 years to get from the lab component to the opening of the museum, and to which degree that also would dovetail with other institutions in the area.
So in the early years, MIT, Boston Public Library, Museum of Fine Arts, to save money, they shared library resources, but they bought the scientific publications and began to accumulate them. So the creation of a new library, you know, of an actual library besides a departmental collection came in the late 19th century. The Institute created an archives in 1961, and it created a museum in 1971. And this is unique, this is really unique to a place like MIT. Science, technology, we're about the future. We don't care about the past. Now, people tell you that all the time. Engineers, they don't like the future. You know, they're not interested in history. Well, don't believe it. It's not true. People want to win Nobel Prizes. They want to get patents. What they care about is the subject of originality. Professional academic historians are trained to care much more about causality. Why things happened, when, you know, all the social, cultural forces, and so forth. So the other thing, when we did our 150th exhibit, is I didn't call it a history of MIT. I just said we're collecting stories and stuff.
Yeah.
And it turns out everybody has loved stories, and everybody has stuff. And once you took that word, it was the word that was acting like that, you know, electric collar or something, you know, and those invisible fences that shock the dogs, you know, so they don't trespass into another realm. People willingly walked in when they heard, you know, they could tell their own stories and engage with stories. So I don't get too hung up on some of those words. I think it's very interesting as a historian, but I'm practically speaking as a strategy, not there. On the, you're asking the question about collecting stuff, though.
There were certain things, because you mentioned that you had these really bizarre five things, and that's sort of the historical focus. Yeah. And I wonder whether that also reflects that perhaps some other things were given to other institutions because of historical understanding.
So the answer is sort of yes, except we didn't have an art school. So we had the first school of architecture in the United States, so we have really extensive drawings. In fact, probably the best collection of architectural education, you know, and pedagogy is there, because we have all the student thesis drawings from 1868 till they abandoned the requirement in 1968. So you want to see Ian Pei's thesis drawings, we have them. Columbia Avery is probably the, you know, one of the next best repositories of such work. But people actually didn't think of MIT as a place to give stuff. Now the most calls that I feel are actually just exactly the kind of stuff you could have used for this exhibit. I have we have an old Apple II, don't want to throw it away, can you give it to them? And I'm like, no. I'm sorry.
You need to come home.
Well, you know, and before it was, they had genuine feelings about the historical relevance. Now they want to save the $10 it costs to, in the town, the recycling fee. This is, I'm not fooling myself on their interest. It's the same thing. People call us up with mercury thermometers. An old barometer. Would you like that? And I'm like, because you don't want to pay for that. So the world is a very interesting one in the display and collecting technology. So we get a lot of requests about things like personal computers. People have just not thought of MIT as a collecting institution, period. So our collections tend to reflect internal interests and needs and desires. That's changed in the last decade or so, because they know we have some of these areas. They know we have a great collection of slide rules, so I get a lot of slide rule offers. But do we get a lot of art? No, we don't get so much on that front. So that may be a function of the ICA or the MFA or Harvard in town, but it's a great question. I haven't really thought about it, but I don't feel like we're losing out stuff.
No, I didn't necessarily mean it in terms of losing, just in terms of understanding how selective holdings are.
If you walk through the stores of any science and technology museum, you notice a really curious imbalance of things. So the molecular biology world is hardly represented at all, whereas, you know, if you go to the natural history museums, you see specimens and taxonomy and so forth. That's there. The people lowest on the biology food chain have the most representation in the museums. The engineers, the aeronautical engineers would preserve the pencil stubs if they thought Lindbergh or Wright walked by. Because their disciplines, and chemical engineering grew up in the 20th century with precisely at the time that mass media grows up, and so they have a sense of importance, that what we do is important and world-changing, and therefore our stuff matters. Other departments, the math department, it's really important, but there's a few math models, but, you know, what do you keep? The chalk? Niels Bohr wrote on this blackboard. I mean, I don't, you know, that's really, so our storerooms would suggest we only do engineering, you know, that aero is really important, that biology isn't important, that, you know, just by disproportionate numbers. And so that's not because we're insensitive to those topics, but in part because the professionalization of those disciplines, some of them, collecting and keeping your stuff is absolutely part of what it means to be a professional in that field. And other disciplines, you don't want to have your stuff. Anyway, I could go on and on, and we'll have that chance later.
Yeah, yeah.
So, thank you.
So now we're going to move on to Jonathan Dehan. So Jonathan was I'm going to embarrass him a little bit. Jonathan was like an amazing diamond in the rough kind of find. The initial idea for the interface experience was to have these five working devices. And then came the challenge of getting someone who could write programming for these five wide-ranging devices that covered over 30 years of life and five completely different programming platforms, two of which are obsolete, one of which is kind of obsolete and hard to deal with, and two which are relevant, but one is very difficult because that has to do with gestural control. So how could you find a single body who did all of that, understood and appreciated the humanistic questions that the show is dealing with, and also happened to have worked at the Met Museum and understood all the underpinnings of those kind of museum questions. So fortunately, I had talked to Jonathan a couple of years previously about this project, and he had been excited, and we were able to connect, and it's just been a remarkable achievement, you know, to not say short, that those things are all working in the gallery as well as they are. So as we were talking and thinking about this symposium, and Jonathan and I were sharing the kind of crazy path he went through to get these devices working and find these old programming languages buried away on the internet. And now actually it's interesting that I'm hearing what Deborah was saying about what gets saved, and especially process-based things like math. You know, you don't save the chalk. And so what are people saving from software development? And then who's saving it, if we're kind of ambivalent about how best to save it in the museums currently? Well, it appears that amateurs on the internet are saving a lot of this. And because they're saving it in weird ways, it requires a certain type of intellectual archaeology to delve into these systems to be able to unearth all those challenges and then bring them all back together, compose them, and follow a professor's lead over what he demands to have in the gallery. So so Jonathan got it all working and was also able to do it all with the scripts that the students from my class composed, which is another interesting part of the story, is that I had five and six students, many of whom had never used a couple of the devices, and then had to go into the devices and learn how to use them, and then learn how to write scripts to explain to other people how to use these devices. So this whole story comes out through the experience of the gallery, but it's also an interesting one to share. And so Jonathan's going to share that part of it. And so I'll read. Jonathan, oops, I lost my page. I used to be good at technology. Jonathan likes to connect random inputs and outputs to see what people will do with them. Jonathan often takes virtual streams and provides them physical facilities to exaggerate their impact on our lives. Jonathan's equally comfortable coding in C, C++, Rust, JavaScript, CoffeeScript, Python, Piet, Basic, Hypercard, and Bash. Jonathan painted a simple Echo program and could very easily see himself holed up for the winter just with canvas and line.
thanks, Kamon. That bio's a little weird to hear in like this context, because it's like, it's my, hey, I want to make art bio, and this is hopefully how I'll get all the artists to take me more seriously. So this project was amazing. I had an incredibly fun time working on it. There'll be some slides and things to look at over there in a little bit, but I just wanted to say that for the first couple of minutes, I'm just going to go through what technologies we used and the process of getting them working both at home and in the gallery, and then quickly move past that and talk about, for me, what was new and interesting was the research aspect that was something that, you know, I didn't, I went to school for computer science. I passed that. I have no formal education after my bachelor's. So the idea of doing like deep research instead of, oh, just make a thing work, just do another thing was pretty exciting for me. And then there'll be a little bit of time for Q&A afterwards. But I'm going to get pretty deep into the weeds. And the talk is a bit of an experiment because unlike the like incredibly interesting linear narrative that we just heard, working on these devices and making the connections were very much like a map, you know, not like a map with no roads. I don't know how to describe it in any other way besides jumping back and forth, and like that's my talk's going to do that a little bit. So if at any time there's a word or a number or a screen that is just confusing, please, during the talk, like most people are like, save questions for Q&A later, please interrupt me and I will tell you whether or not that question will be answered soon, or I can, you know, it's just something that I glossed over because of my, like, I was so into the thick of things. So I'm gonna just set this up.
We might want a tiny bit more light in here, so
oh,
you could
please,
see
yeah.
us.
Yeah, that would be nice to see everyone's faces. That maybe you won't have to interrupt. I'll just see eyes glazed over. Or, okay, so let's see. So can we turn that on? Should be yeah. The presenter software, great.
Cool.
And we're going to just have why not that tab for now. Alright, so that's just something to look at right now while I start talking. And I'll be jumping between software, websites, communities, things like that. Alright. So when Kimon asked me to do this project, he mentioned that a few years ago we had talked about it. That was when I was working at the Met, and it was a little bit, it was like, oh, this sounds really neat, but it wasn't this like fully formed idea in my head. It was just like, hey, meet Kimon, he's really cool, he's doing some very interesting things, and we think that like your paths will cross, and they did. And then when he recontacted me, I guess 7 months ago, maybe 8, I had just left the museum, and he didn't, when he proposed, like, oh yeah, write these 5 apps for 5 different platforms, many of which I haven't, like, I have never written code for before. At the time, he didn't know it, but I had no idea if I could even program the devices. In fact, I was really sure I wasn't going to be able to do something for the Palm Pilot, but that maybe I could just like listen to what he's trying to do in the gallery and maybe provide some alternatives or like some way to really get at the heart of what he was trying to do, and maybe temper expectations. But the thought of being paid to program something in HyperCard was like so exciting for me, because a lot of the artists that I follow these days and a lot of the people that inspire me as a programmer and as an artist, a lot of them cut their teeth on HyperCard, and you can see it in their work today, and you can see it in their workflow today, that the patience that they have in creating new pieces, even though they're digital artists, are just kind of pretty far removed from the culture of like modern startup programmer culture. So I responded to him that, yeah, well, absolutely, all these things are totally reasonable, and like maybe it helped that, you know, we were on, you know, museum time, small museum time, which is still like pretty fast, but you know, 7 months is like an eternity in programming and technology. So I have to apologize to Kimon for the half-truth that, oh yeah, this will be no problem. And And I have to really thank him for trusting me enough to follow through with all this, because that wasn't easy. That was really helpful. Anyway, so 3 months before, if he had asked me if I could do this stuff, it wouldn't have, like, it wouldn't have worked out. But I had just participated in a program called Hacker School, and they helped give me the confidence, support, and they had some old machines that I got to play around with while I was there, to really know an approach that would work. It also helped that while I was working for Don and Dean at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, so I did a project where we recreated Corey Archangel's Super Mario Clouds. thank you. That's new. And this was one of my first, like, more academic, at least for me, forays into digital preservation and understanding hardware and software. And what I did there, long story short, and this is a very instructive, like, blog post. This has a very small amount about the humanities, but about the impact of this work. But the idea was, at least at the Media Lab, was to get people, by the end of these two articles, to, the question was, like, all right, we have art copyist programs in museums where you would just look at a painting and you would recreate it, and in doing the process, you would learn a lot about the context. You would learn not only to be a better painter by figuring out, oh, this layer has to go before this layer, or these techniques have to go around here, but how do you learn about, like, the mindset of the person who is creating it and the time? So I went through and did this, and I think this also kind of helped prepare me a little bit into what are these interactives that we're making in the gallery? What are they, like, what purpose are they serving? How are they gonna have people who've never used these machines before feel afterwards? And what kind of things are they gonna hold on to? So, I'm gonna mostly focus on the three earliest machines, the Commodore 64, the Mac Plus, and the Palm Pilot. The span of computers that I ended up programming was over 31 year period of time, which for the history of personal computing is like at least over 50% of the entire history, closer to 75, I'd say. And the older machines were kind of a bit more interesting of a research project, but there are some echoes in what it's like to program these devices and what it's like to be able to share the techniques, because a lot of the techniques that I was learning weren't packaged well for, like, other people to reuse. And since doing this, I've had a lot of interest of people who wanted to recreate, like learn how to program for the HyperCard and for the Pompa, because Kumon's been super supportive of every idea I said, we should do this. He's like, yeah, that sounds great. All of the code and all of the techniques that I've used for other programmers are available online, and they can pick up at exactly the point that all these interactives are in the gallery and then build their own experiences out of it. And that's, I've gotten a lot of support from, like, my peers on that. So, I'm gonna start by opening Vice. So the technology. So, this is Vice. For all the technologies, if I want to be developing comfortably and really with quick iterations, a lot of software development is done with, you write a bunch of stuff, you wait some time, the computer responds, you see if that response is what you want, you see why it's broken, and then you think for a while. And then you write some more stuff, and you repeat this loop. And the shorter you make that loop of feedback, the better your intuition becomes, and the, like, you've just become a better programmer that way. So the feedback loop for these devices when I started was incredibly long. First of all, I didn't have a Mac Plus at home. I didn't have a Commodore 64 at home. I didn't have a Palm Pilot, although those were actually really available and easy to get on eBay and cheap. So I ended up buying one for myself. And there needed to be a way to kind of like fake, develop on fake hardware before I could go and test it on the real thing, just to shorten that loop. So a lot of the devices, first couple of months of development was just figuring out, can we even emulate this software? And if we do emulate it, how can we get the development environment set up for machines that were meant to be programmed in like 1999 or 1989 or 1982? So this is VICE. This is what an emulator looks like. It's a piece of software that acts like hardware, and it lets you run anything that you could run on the original hardware, supposedly. There are bugs. I found bugs in the emulators, and bugs being inconsistencies. The weird part about making emulators is that you want to emulate all the problems with the old machine, because the software relies on the problems, which is wholly bizarre. So there's, if you want to talk about specific problems with these machines, we can do that after in the QA or just talk to me. But the general idea is like, you can type in a program. So programs never run the first time.
Right.
And yeah, of course. And then they also, I'm missing a semicolon there. All right, let's see if this will run. No, it won't, right? So then you have to be like, where did I mess up and what's gonna happen here? The point is that this is essentially the same thing that the, that I'd be running on the real hardware. So this is VICE. This is what the Commodore 64 emulator looks like.
Except you'd be typing a lot slower and making more typo mistakes on the keyboard.
Yeah, so that's the thing. Like, this is a comfortable development environment because I can backspace really easy, because the keys can, like, they have action, and the layout is, I mean, the Commodore 64 is a UK, like, keyboard. So the at sign and the quote sign are not exactly swapped, but you have to relearn where keys are, which is really annoying. But what ended up happening is, if you go online, you can download a zip file with the software and the emulators for running the software that's running upstairs. And you can run it on your own machine, and you can make modifications and play around with it. So if I go to the C64 and hit thing and then drag it over. So now, this looks really similar, but this is the interactive that's running in the gallery right now. So if I type anything, it says type load PS, and you can go through and, you know, run it. What you'll notice here is, like, there's flickering on the screen on the real machine, and there's not flickering here, and that's because the emulator is not perfect. Although, the emulator is trying to pretend to be an old screen, because you can see the scan lines. Those scan lines are not necessary, but the person who wrote VICE said, no, it's crucial to, like, how the graphics looked back then. So what are the other emulators I used? I used Mini VMAC, which when you open it up, just gives you that. And then you have to drag files onto it, disk files, and then you get a full machine. I'm not going to go through a demonstration of Mini VMAC. And then for the Palm Pilot, the best and possibly only working emulator on any modern machine is actually for your phone, for Android phones. And I I kind of thought this was amazing that when you press the power button on the, there's a brightness button on the Palm Pilot, whoever decided to make this emulator, and they're all made by like one person with a bunch of help from a bunch of other contributors, they decided that like the backlight, they would pretend to have a backlight on your phone by making it blue. So, there we go, I have to turn the speaker off. So after doing the research to find, okay, there's like ways you can run old software, then it was a matter of getting the old software, and that was really hard. The versioning hell is like a term of industry, version hell for modern programming. It's like, I depend on this set of code that, but like this version of this set of code for my thing to work, and then somebody updated it, and now my thing's broken. That was like 1,000 times worse back then. It took, there were no file name extensions, there were no, I mean, there were file name extensions, but they didn't tell you anything about the files, and you couldn't really inspect the files. So like, I would download, I'd spend hours just like downloading from random websites, like HyperCard 1.0, and trying everything possible to open it up in Mini VMAC in this emulator, and thinking what this is showing, what this icon is showing, is like, what? Why isn't it opening? Is it a corrupted download? Am I misreading this? Was I supposed to use a different utility? And the figuring that out, like, there is no one I could just like turn to and just ask, because this is 30 years old, or 15 years old. But there were some places that started to show promise. So let's quit out of here. Quit out of that. So, the Internet Archive is amazing. One, they are preserving software probably better than anyone else out there right now, and making it accessible. Not just preserving, but allowing you to run these pieces of software in your browser without having to understand what an emulator is or download it. It's a little bit buggy. But actually, that was not the resource. That's the resource I went to first, was like click on software and see, like, can I, you know, old school emulation, classic PC games, maybe I could find some starting point there. But that wasn't the most important resource that I found in here, and it was actually the Wayback Machine. Mm-hmm. So if you go to palmos.com, you're not going to get Palm the company. Palm the company is gone. You're going to get this ad site that doesn't do anything. It's just like, here, click on this stuff. And every single tutorial that you can find on the web, a news group tutorial of like, hey, step one of developing for the Palm, download the software, and the link is to palmos.com/whatever. And there's nothing you could do, except if you went here. And then if you went here and you said, well, I know I'm developing for the Palm OS device, like the Palm Professional, and it's running Palm OS 2.0, so I think like I should be looking, you know, around here to look at this website. And all right, site looks pretty good. Oh, you know what? That's a picture of a way too new Palm. I need to go back like another year. It's actually earlier than I'm working with. But at the very least, they do an incredible job at letting you not only browse the web pages, but if we can find, that's developers and developers program. At some point, they made you sign up for their website to download stuff, and that doesn't work anymore. So you have to like find the version of the website that lets you just download without signing up. And you can see the emulator here, but that doesn't run on any modern machine. There, Palm OS SDK version 3.5, and if you click it, it will, this one might bring you to the sign-up site, but if it doesn't, it'll just start downloading, which will be great. You have to agree to this, which is like, not even, like, this can't be legally bunting anymore. They're a defunct company, right? So, yeah. So that's how I got the Palm OS software, and a lot of like. There's a few threads in this kind of jumpy around talk, and one of them is that like there is like very few but very dedicated people with communities that have been keeping these alive for their own enjoyment, for their own gratification. The person who wrote the FemPom emulator, Jason Scott is not the only person who does Internet Archive by a long shot. It's a ton of people, and they're all doing a ton of work and a lot of volunteers. But the archive as a whole is one of the larger and more established institutions. But many of the software and hardware and information that I got was from a small community. One person wrote a piece of software. 15 people loved it and started to build a community around it. And now there's 150 people who are programming old Nintendos or there's a huge Commodore 64 scene. That first tab that I showed is just like, this is a game released like, what, a couple of weeks ago? Like 10 days ago, someone released a game for the Commodore 64.
Wow.
It's a remaster of an old game, but like there are people who are actively programming these things, and the graphics, the C64 games didn't look like this. This is an incredibly good programmer. And you could run it, not upstairs, on your own, or in an emulator. So just from the point of like getting into the weeds of things, you need to have emulators on your computer to have any semblance of a decent development environment. You need to set up there's a lot of supporting software that goes into just getting a basic Hello World running. But once you have that, you know, things just work in a really crazy sense. You know, the layers of fragility upon layers of fragility of emulation, they just work. So finding the software I talked about, and then really, like, how do you tap into these communities? So another kind of experimental idea I had for this talk is opening up a live chat room with the internet. And I apologize if there are any, I don't know, if there's mean things people say on the internet, but that's what it is. This is how I got an incredible amount of support for like the Commodore 64 community. So let's just join C64. It might take a couple of seconds. So each of these chat channels are where developers and enthusiasts of all sorts of different communities hang out and talk. And this is the one for Commodore 64. And I don't know if it says how many people are in the room right now, but it's not many. It's like maybe 40 people right now. But you can go back and look at the logs of this room, which is just a history of what people have been chatting about, and see, you know, me asking questions, really basic questions, like, how come none of my code runs? And I link to it, and they're like, you typed it in all caps. And the Commodore looks like it's in all caps, but actually, it's in all lowercase, they just render the font that way. So when I tried to run my program, it was like really dumb false starts that are just like assumed knowledge and assumed context of that time. When you got a Commodore 64, you didn't get it with no instruction manual, you got it with a book, and that book you would read cover to cover to do anything, because you couldn't just start smashing your keyboard and getting any useful output. This happened again when I got the HyperCard software. I bought like 5 copies of HyperCard on eBay, and most of them were just like 1 or 2 discs, and they kind of worked and they kind of didn't work, but the version that I needed that was like shrink wrap, new in box, it was a humongous box. And that was because 3/4 of it were manuals, like 5 manuals, a quick start guide, a manual, a tutorial, practices, a card to be part of the club, the HyperCard club, you know? And the kind of development that happens is not one of looking up references and looking up examples. That's how modern software development, a lot of it is done. It's just like, look at what other people have done, look up examples, read the reference, and piece together what you're trying to do. With the expectation with these machines is that they would they teach you when you got them how to use them. And for me, it meant just reading on the subway cover to cover, not really looking for anything, just trying to get an understanding of the metaphor used at the time. And all these old machines had a metaphor. They had usually a single metaphor for how to think about the interface, mm-hmm. for how to think about the programming, which mirrored the interface, and which was invariably deeply connected with the hardware. Like, there was very little separation between the hardware and the software. So, for example, like the Palm Pilot had the idea of forms, and that was the main idea. You worked with forms. In HyperCard, you worked with cards. You had cards and you had stacks, and one would link to another. And once you understood that metaphor and a metaphor of messaging, you can either send a message or you can do something when you hear a message, you being a card or a stack. So this is the mental model of how do you program. You think of yourself as the computer listening and sending messages, and you hope that your metaphor aligns with the author's and that your software does the thing it's supposed to do. And this came about mostly because there was really only one programmer or one author for these older systems. When you open up HyperCard, Bill Atkinson is 1.0, written by Bill Atkinson, no one else. He's the only, when you can choose icons for buttons, he's the only icon that is of a person, and it's his own face, because he drew all the icons, okay? And often you can get their phone numbers, and you can try, like, their software would have their phone number on the page, and I'm like, oh, great, I can call them up and actually ask them to teach me HyperCard, because they're totally going to remember after 30 years. And, you know, I thought they'd be excited to talk about it, and some were and some weren't. I end up calling, like, magazines are really, like, hobbyist magazines are one of the only publications that, like, really show you what people were doing with, like, the Commodore and the Palm. And I called up people who ran them in the 90s, and they're like, yeah, I don't do that anymore, click. Like really, you know, there's one hobbyist magazine that the person was just like, I've got, like, a job and kids, and I just ran this for a couple of years, it was okay, you know? So the research aspect to me was, like, it was super interesting, but also, again, a lot of false starts. I'm going to skip over the hardware a little bit, even though I love it a lot. I don't want to, like, I want panel discussion to happen more. But needless to say, there are also other communities that have created, like, really useful pieces of hardware that let me transfer stuff from my computer to those old machines. And again, without all these people who are interested for their own reasons supporting, like, there'd be no way that all the software would get finished in the time it did. And for all these communities, I've just donated to all of them because their work has been, like, invaluable in learning how these systems work too. And then we can talk about, oh yeah, okay, so how much time do we have?
5 minutes.
5 minutes? Okay. There's a bunch of, like, really small stories with each of the machines and each of the pieces of software, like finding really, really, really strange games that people made that just we wouldn't find in the App Store today. These devices encouraged creativity and kind of expected from the user, oh, you have a computer, you're going to be programming then. You might be doing other stuff. You might be making art, you might be like visual art, or you might be making sounds, or you might be doing, you know, some serious work, but all these kind of small, like, what we call indie games now is, like, a big industry. Back then, people, like, when they got these machines, they would make weird things, and I could talk about the really weird games that we found. The The only other thing I want to mention, I guess, is that the similarities and differences in programming these old machines and newer ones. So like, there are a few ideas that survive today that the metaphors are present in modern programming. So that makes it a little bit easier to like, oh, here's where things came from. And without, yeah, I think it's okay to do this. Okay. So hopefully you'll be able to, this will be big enough. Okay. I'll make it a little bit bigger. So some ideas survived and some didn't. And here's one example. Just if you've never seen code before, this is what code looks like. It's colorful text. It's colored because it helps the programmer differentiate between metaphors. On the left-hand side is code for HyperTalk to make a button pop up when you click somewhere. And the thing it says is on click, ask something. And the thing that matters most is this on click. Now on the right hand side, this is JavaScript. Kind of an old version of JavaScript, but still works in your browser today. And that JavaScript, if I can move the cursor to it, has on click. So this is 30 years later, the idea of events and messages keeping the same terminology. And then some things didn't survive. Like, there are keywords in HyperTalk that are just like the word the, and they don't do anything except make your code more human readable. All modern languages have the most minimal amount of keywords they can get away with. So it reads like machine language and not like human prose. And I couldn't figure out what the commonalities were between what ideas survived and what didn't. And that's something that like I want to spend more time researching and figuring out if it's an engineering perspective or if it's political or like economic pressures that like make these ideas continue on or not. I said I would get deep into the weeds, so I had to show, I can't talk without showing some code, and sorry, I apologize for that, but hopefully some of this gets you an idea for what it's like to program or to work in digging up ancient computers and ancient programs, and how do you like preserve the software itself and the interactions themselves. And if you have any questions at all, please open up the field there. Yeah.
About kind of the idea of ownership, I guess, and the ownership of ideas. For I think in academia or in a lot of settings, there's a lot of emphasis placing on giving one person owns an idea and that person needs to be acknowledged for what they've done. But it seems like if you go over to the gallery, you know, there's the wall when you first get out of the elevator, it says, you know, help curated by 10 people maybe.
Mm-hmm.
But in this case, it seems like there's actually, you know, hundreds of people to an extent, and
yeah.
I don't know if there's, it seems like the way you're talking is more more open, in that people want the software to be circulated and want people to adapt it, but I don't know if there's any, how do people, what's the reception towards something like that, where you're bringing something that's more, you know, open into a setting that's more closed, and
sure.
Ownership is placed on it, so how does that transfer over, does it transfer over, are there issues with that?
So it's a really good question. First of all, there's the process of like, software developers do share their code for a lot of different reasons. They share it to show off a technical prowess. They share it because they know that the more exposure they get, the better jobs they can get. They share it because they just want fame. They share it just because they think it'll help someone else and they derive satisfaction out of that. But most of the time, acknowledgement is like like a tenant of this. Like you definitely want to acknowledge all the people that helped you get to your point. And in engineering, you're borrowing a lot of other people's codes, and there's very specific, like, licensing is a big part of it. So for software licenses, like if you go to, so this is a social network where you can share your code with people and they can comment on it and submit ideas for improving your software or take your software and do something new with it. And on here, so these are the five interactives, there are links to them. On here, like the first things that I'm put down are just like the massive amount of people and this is, and for each of these interactives, I break it down even further to like the individuals of, you know, how that can happen. And like, that's just being like a nice person. But but for many of these projects, they have specific licensing terms. So, for example, for the Palm Pilot, there was a piece of software I used called Docker to do virtualization, and it's built on a GPL license, and that license, it has a very specific set of criteria that is usually, if you modify this software, you have to share back your modifications. That's a general class of software licenses. And for a lot of what I did, this was me sharing back, great, because I couldn't send Palm OS my modifications, like they're not there anymore. But for some of the newer developers, the Cairoflux project, which did hardware, I most definitely, like as much as my knowledge, tried to abide by the licenses that are recognized in like U.S. in my jurisdiction, right? I hope that answers that question, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Knowing what you know about museum roles, how would you say that this work that you did here, did you feel more, this is sort of speculative, did you feel more like a curator or more like a conservator? I see a lot of both in what you did.
Wow,
you
know. Thank you. For me, I mostly saw myself as a conservator. Like, what I chose were, whenever I made decisions that were like wholly up to me, they were mostly pragmatic decisions involving the involving like what technologies to use, because that's what we needed to get this interaction done. That being said, I had tons of conversations with Kimon where it was never like one-sided, like let's do this thing. It was always a conversation about like what are we trying to achieve in the galleries. There's a particularly nasty bug with the menu system on the Apple, and like we just kind of had to accept some limitation and figure out, okay, what does that tell us about this machine? We're using it in a way that it wasn't meant to be used. And with the Palm Pilot, we don't sandbox that environment. That environment, to start the interaction or the interactive, you have to go into the real operating system, hit applications, hit int exp, and that's all told on the label, which is just like no one reads that. But I mean, everyone in this room read it, and that just brought a smile to my face. But like. But I wouldn't say, like, the devices and also, like, the students were the ones that came up with the scripts, and I didn't want to, I gave feedback on the scripts, and some of them were feedback just, again, pragmatically, we can't do this, it's just not possible. And some of them were just opinion, like, hey, I think this is a little bit more, gets to the meat of what you're talking about. But I definitely felt that my role in this was more conservationist, and a lot of the work that I did that I would consider like extra work and not really necessary for the show to be like successful and for the opening to be successful was me providing tools for other programmers to be able to run all their old software, to be able to program, especially for the Palm. I have the only HyperCard 2.1 version I could possibly find on the internet, and I have the only working compiler for Palm. That's something that I wanted to share back and to to me that was like definitely a conservator. Just like, oh, I need to do this, other people might like this, you know.
Yeah. Speaking of conservation, I wondered if in this process you began to evolve your thinking about how you would train the next generation of computer conservators. You know, like,
yeah.
When we get archivist interns, you know, you start them out by sorting papers and putting them in acid, you know, taking staples out. And I wondered if, just looking at this subset of five, if there are ones that are good starters for people to learn, you
sure.
know, about versus, you know, ones that proved really, really challenging.
Yeah, I mean, I'd say the Commodore, because it's the simplest device, and that because it's the simplest device, so many programmers have reverse engineered it, figured out how it works, extended it, that it's really easy for people to just start programming in, and it might be like a little. Mr. Miyagi to just be like, oh, start them by like giving them a manual and write a program for the Commodore. That's like, that doesn't help them with the conservation. That doesn't teach them about emulators directly. But it teaches them the mindset of how these programmers thought. And oftentimes, like, you need to think like they thought, and they had a very set, and like, they have very specific cultural background, right? Like, so programming for the Commodore, you had to think like an Englishman, you know, like a rich Englishman, and like, you know, programming for the HyperMac, for HyperCard, you had to think like a California hippie, you know, like, and that really does help you figure out what those words are to open the door to the communities that already exist out there. Because until you find the communities to help you out, like, you're kind of just lying around. So I'd say the C64 is a great starting point for conservation, because it's the emulators are super simple, the language and the things you can learn are a very small subset, and then they will naturally start asking questions like, okay, I got it running on my machine, how do I package this? What do we put on the website? Do we like embed a video of this, or do we give them a package? Wait, it only works on Mac? Now they start thinking about software distribution and the relation between operating systems and software, and just those inquiries enough is already like such a level above in being able to evaluate, like, yeah, how do we keep software alive? Because so much software succumbs to what's called bit rot, and it just, you just can't run it again until some crazy person reads an old manual and rewrites the Cray supercomputer for their laptop, which, like, there's one guy in Brooklyn who did it, and he made like a scale model, and it runs real Cray software, and it's the only running Cray in the world that like is not the real one. So, yeah. So there's C64 is a great starting point, and another nice thing about GitHub is that you can look at the history of the software development, change by change. And my descriptions are terrible because I was just under time constraints and like, but you know, like.
They're better than this, don't they?
Yeah, like, you know, let's see, cheat and clear the screen. Okay, look, so like, it's a description of what I did, it's a highlight of the line of code that was changed, and by following this, you can kind of see what I learned, what mistakes I made, and that becomes hugely helpful in like, you don't just read 250 lines of code or 10,000 lines of code and understand how it works. You have to see its evolution. So that's another nice thing about like it being up here, is that if you want to teach people how to do software preservation, it's also a good idea just to read the titles, you know, or like, oh man, I have to renumber each line every time I want to add or remove a line. Okay,
wow.
All right, that's just some arcane knowledge. Yeah. I hope that answers.
I think we can take a break really quickly. There's coffee outside. We'll reconvene in about 10 minutes, and we'll have a panel with you.
That one's good.
Wait, trading off.
Test. Test.
So one thing that was interesting in planning the semesters for the events was that we always have these scholars days and mini symposia after the opening of shows, and I had also planned on inviting Tobin Smith and Jennifer Foley for a symposium on digital interpretation at another point in the semester. And one thing we thought, well, wouldn't it be great to have them back to back and make it a 2-day event? So hopefully you can all come back tomorrow. Another thing, I'll say this because I've been reminded to say it and I realize I haven't said it. Another neat thing about our show is the interface experience, because it was the show is completely made of devices bought on eBay for a combined total of less than $7,000, it is eminently torrable. So if you know of a museum that this would be a great show to send to, or if you represent a museum that would like to take our show on tour even more directly, that is something to talk. And Marianne's in the back, and you can tell her. Yeah. that was another fun part of all this that was unintentional. But you know, once you get to the space where you're working with these accessible kind of popular objects, it puts away the barriers of conservation and loan and different levels of ownership, and it would be great to see if a tour that is so personal can travel to different communities around the country, around the world, and inspire different types of reactions. And there are ways to record stories on the web app for the exhibition, so that will be an interesting journey. So we've put these two symposia together, and what that also affords is another opportunity is that our speakers for tomorrow, Jennifer and Coven, can participate in the conversation today, because the ideas of exhibiting interface technology and the questions on a broader sense of putting digital technologies and interpretive materials in museums are not separate. So the way we're going to run the panel today and tomorrow as well is that the people who are not speaking today are going to provide kind of beginning comments to kick off the panel discussion. And then we're just going to open up from there. If you had a question that didn't get asked, you would like to ask Deborah or Jonathan or myself. Or if you have a question for anything that Coven or Jennifer have to say, please feel free. And we have until 4:30, at which point we have to get kicked out of the room because our survey is in here at 5 o'clock, and we cannot deny the first years their download of information. as Carlin drops his head in sadness. So I guess I want to start with Jennifer and or Coven. You guys can fight over who gets to go first.
No, we already took care of that.
Okay, great.
So actually, Kimon, my first question is for you. One, I need to apologize for giving Kimon a heart attack. The line at Starbucks was longer than we anticipated. So sorry that we're starting a little late. That's me and Jennifer's fault. Jennifer's and my fault. Kimon, my question is for you, which is, I'm thinking a little bit about whether this kind of quote-unquote old technology represents a potential like oncoming land grab for museums, you know, thinking about as people start to value these as collections, are we going to start to grab what's left in the world of them? And you sat at a sort of unique point in history in that there's still a fair amount of this stuff available and still available for fairly cheaply, which allowed you to think about preserving the interface in a sort of abstract sense, as opposed to just preserving the objects. So my question, there is one coming, I promise.
Okay.
My question.
I can do it like this. So, yeah.
So my question is, would you have structured this differently if, for instance, you knew that this was the last Commodore 64 in existence? Mm-hmm. Versus, you know, knowing that, okay, there's others out there, so we can wreck this one in trying to make it work if we have to.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting that the project is kind of a unique combination of so many specific factors that are not repeatable almost, in that sense. And it goes back to the question that Deborah was asked, like, are we a vault? You know, maybe there's good things about being a vault, that we have controlled systems, and this is going against that. To maybe open up more traditional modes, but yeah, no. If it's the last one, you know, put it on a plinth, put it behind plastic, because those devices are going to be dead by the end of the show. You know, the Mac particularly, you can hear it humming away its death slowly. You know? And we actually the key about those five devices is that there's two of them in the building at all times. It's because when one breaks, you don't fix it. You know, it's going to cost so much more to find someone who can, I mean, it was hard to find Jonathan, to find someone who's going to go and fix a Mac Plus.
at a cost of less than the $500 that it is to buy another one on eBay. They're disposable and renewable in that sense, and we've made sure of that. So I think that we're at a good point where we can actually think about future conservation practices and the values of this. And there's a museum that does that, right? So the Computer History Museum has a lot of these things, and they have them in deep storage, and I knew I would never get access to them, which is why I never asked. And so I guess that goes to what Deborah was saying, too, is that we need tiers of understanding our material culture rather than a single way of thinking of like conservation and presentation. And so you buy three, you put one in deep storage, you put one as maybe a playable object that comes out every now and then you have the one that is about kind of the recent past. And ultimately, I wasn't exhibiting the objects, I was exhibiting the experience of using the objects. You know, I think that's the trick too. And so it was kind of like when you try to exhibit performance. I'm a theater PhD. You can't really exhibit theater because the minute it ends, it's over. So how do you kind of evoke that use? And so the device has become a platform for an experience. And it's that experience we were trying to exhibit rather than the devices. But since we're used to exhibiting devices, that's what we go back to as the default. So that's a long answer to your question.
So I think in listening to the two talks, it was one thing that really struck me was that, Deborah, at the beginning of your talk, you said something about that it wasn't just about the physical or the tangible interface, that it was about the cultural interface as well. And that then in listening to Jonathan, you were saying, like, when you were talking about kind of going through the process of programming and trying to think about the programmer and as well as the system itself, and that it struck me that both of you were essentially talking about empathy. And that I thought that was sort of, it was an interesting kind of place for both of them, being that both of them are kind of talking about technology and things that I think culturally we often think of as being dissociated from humanity, from empathy, from that kind of that interaction between humans as being just about machine. And so I just thought it was an interesting strain through the two of them. And it struck me that I wondered why it is that discussions of empathy don't come up more often in talking about computers, in talking about the history of technology.
So I'm going to make a generalized comment and then see if I can work my way back to a more specific answer to yours, to your question. But this relates to something that Kimon said, which is, if you think about maritime museums, there's a really active culture of preservation, of boat building, restoration, rebuilding, that extends to their archival, the treatment and handling techniques associated with their archival collections. So that if you were to come, if you want to build a Hirschhoff yacht, you could come to us, or you want to, you know, need a boat plan at Mystic Seaport, you can call them up and they will deliver that. And, you know, until relatively recently, our curator would run those plans right through, you know, an engineering copier, and you would be delivered your, you know, print. So these plans in our collection are, you know, paper, linen, vellum, various substrates with ink of various types on top of them. Contrasted in the flat file cabinets right next to it is the architecture plans, those drawings, which are also paper, linen, vellum, with various kinds of ink and so forth on them. And my colleague, our curator of architecture and design, just reacts in horror to the treatment of these plans that the Hart Nautical Collections curator does. Because in the same thing, right? You know, paper with ink on it. But the architectural preservation culture, it grew up out of the art world, so everything is really precious.
So for him, it's got to be in white gloves and laid out and photographed and carefully stitched together and analyzed, and the light levels are this. And what I realize is, I mean, you're both dealing with exceptionally wealthy patrons, but the cultures that have grown up about preservation in those two worlds are very different. And one of them, this is to work my way back to your question about empathy, has to do with, in some ways, if you are treating this plan as a recipe to do something physical, you're trying to get into the mindset of the boat builder. And if you're in the mindset of the boat builder, well, then plans are things you use. And they're not precious, they're vital, but they're not jewels that you carry around. Whereas if you're treating a building as if it's the symbol of a city, then the drawing acquires different values. And so your levels of empathy are in a totally different place. Now, I say all this because in the science and technology world, part of the professionalization is to try to remove yourself from the sense of feelings. This is Taylorism in scientific management. I mean, I think we're in an era, you know, where the archivists and people are just, you know, how do we manage the workflow of big data? You know, once you have petabytes of material, how do you manage that? And you have to do it, I think, by disassociating yourself from that. So that's a stab at this, which is the nature of the way in which one is professionalized, but one can see variations from activity, or from collecting group to collecting group, as to the boat builders think empathy is really important. You got to get inside the minds of them, but not so much the architectural historian. Curiously, just a different world. Anyway.
Yeah, I actually say that there are a few places that where there's a lot of discussion around empathy with technology, in particular, like the School for Poetic Computation and the Recurse Center, which used to be called Hacker School. I think these are people who, you know, grew up and used, well, especially in Hacker School, grew up and used like technology constantly for their whole lives. And because of their understanding of the creation of new tools and new software, they also know how non-objective it is, the process, and how it can influence, you know, anyone who's using it. Depending on what you're trying to achieve, you can decide to create software that is very deliberately trying to evoke an emotion or provoke a reaction, or you can decide to try and make something that that is like as objective as possible. But I think a lot of software writers nowadays, at least the ones I surround myself with, they think of themselves in almost like a journalistic like rigor. Like they're very intentionally trying to compartmentalize their bias and decide to use it or not, you know, we're seeing that in like even more popular and older places like ITP. You'll see various treatments of empathy with technology.
But just coincidentally, I mean, the discussions around gender, though, in games right now are kind of blowing the lid off of, you know, that veneer or facade of objectivity. In the gaming world. So I would just say that, by the way, parallels the same conversations had about 30 years ago when women were integrated into the military, particularly women as fighter pilots. The same reactions were occurring, so at the time. But
yes, we're not
yeah.
That's right. But it's the point is that the sociologists tell us that communities are their most inclusive in times of crisis, when the risks to life and limb are greatest and the economic benefits are lowest, and that communities are their most exclusive when the risks to life and limb are lowest and the economic benefits are highest. So you can take that for what it is, but I think that might have something to say about empathy.
And the project started, I was having a conversation with Ivan Gaskell, who's the head of the Focus Guy project earlier, like how these shows evolve. And originally I was going to do this thing where there's the knowledge pyramid, where there's data, information, and wisdom, and each progress is like, each step in that pyramid, there's more context and understanding. And I was going to make an argument that depending on the, you know, going from the keyboard to the mouse, to the touch screen, to the non-gesture, like we were moving farther down our accessibility of them. And it was so contrived, at that moment. And it was a good place to start, and maybe it would have made a good exhibition if I stuck with it. But the more I told people about the kinds of objects I was interested in, they were empathizing with the devices, you know, and it was a really personal relationship. Okay. And everyone was like, oh, I remember when. And I was like, well, that's the thing that's clearly sticking. And then I also realized that people rarely, that moment doesn't happen when they're looking at their contemporary devices, and when they're making purchases, choices for new devices. And there's this kind of forward thrust of the industry. There's an industry rhetoric of planned obsolescence and need for newness, and version 1, version 1.2, and, you know, buy the new iPhone, buy the new Samsung phone. And I didn't want to make any judgments on that, but I wanted to be a good historian and try to find a way for people to step back and force themselves to kind of have an empathetic and personal response to their use of these technologies. And so there's a very kind of a dialectical, historical kind of thing going on underneath all of the fun playing with the keys. And it's that you actually get some critical distance of your daily interaction with technology and go, oh my God, like, you know what? I wouldn't be that bad off with a Mac, maybe, you know? Or maybe a Mac from 2 years ago, you know, maybe even not 30 years ago. And to enable that kind of critical positioning, and to open that up, and through personal memories, and not that it's like there's like 12 wall panels explaining how you're overwhelmed by the computing industry, but rather to let people have that kind of experience and open up for themselves a memory once again of this time that most of us remember a good chunk of that time. You know, it's funny, even though my students like to point that they're like this far down on the wall in the gallery, and it makes me feel old because I'm all the way back here on the wall. But it's that idea of creating a history, realizing the history is not that long, that there's been an enormous amount of change in that time. A lot of that change we can survive without, even though it's kind of futuristically pleasing. And to get at that through personal experiences, because they're personal computers, right? Outside of IBM PC, like, it's always been an interesting thing about the relationship individuals have with these devices. And even the Kinect, which is a video game console, or the Palm Pilot, which is a mobile device, they're personal computing devices in a more humanistic sense rather than kind of a technologically defining sense.
Well, I don't know if I appreciate your activist curation, because I think we need to buy more computers. Keep using the thing from 2 years ago? But no, I mean, I'll speak to having exactly that experience telling you this morning, like there was something very different about looking at the TRS-80 on the wall and actually like using the keyboard and hearing that very particular tapping sound that's just distinct to that keyboard. And it was just like this flood of sense memory came back.
Yeah.
It was just like, oh, I haven't heard that sound in, you know, 20 years or whatever it works out to. And it was like, I suddenly had this moment where I was like, I'll bet this is what my Latin American curator feels like when she sees a work that, you know, it's because she has a context for understanding this work that I don't have,
right,
and that I suddenly felt today at that show, and just thinking about empathy.
You invented, Kimon, it's sort of the modern instantiation of Sturbridge Village. Okay, you know, the total immersive experience, you know.
Yeah.
I went to Sturbridge Village as a child, and so of course I had the parallel experience to the very much like Krogan, where I walked into the room and I saw the Atari and I was playing Atari with my brother again. We played the hell out of some Atari. And I had actually forgotten about the paddles. I remember the other controller, but yeah. I had forgotten about the paddles. And I was like, oh, wow. The first thing I thought was, God, you can get this on eBay? I'm going to have to go check eBay. Like, I have to get an Atari again.
That was like 70 bucks and it came with 12 cartridges.
Oh, my God.
And it works.
Totally going on eBay.
Oh, man, did it come with Pitfall?
Oh, yeah, it did. It did. It came with Pitfall and Kanye.
Let's just go down this rabbit hole for
20 minutes. No, actually, so here's another interesting kind of talking about it, like the kinesthetic response thing. So earlier in the day, you and I were both talking about various tendonitises we got from keyboards, and that joystick on the Atari is memorable for many people because of the tendonitis and blisters it would cause. So there's also kind of like this durational time of these things hurting us, but we still like embracing them wholly. Yeah, I remember the blisters from the Nintendo too. And when I was playing with my brother, so.
It seemed like there were probably questions out there.
Yeah.
Well, going back to what Deborah said earlier about how branding sells these themes to youth and how retro is in, I think that in part, what you folks are talking about is a reflection of the culture at large, because anyone can pick up a newspaper style section about clothing or decorating and read, the 70s are in.
Yeah.
Or I was just told this past weekend, the 90s are in. 70s apparently are out. Well, the fact of the matter, and we all know that that people in that world are thinking ahead that way. That's the way they're intended, you know, that's how they make their bread and butter. What you're talking about is a way to bring back an interest in technology that kids have no idea of. I mean, you folks have all been through it, so you're talking fondly about the past. Some 20-year-old doesn't know what the hell that is at all. Excuse me, 15-year-old, that's more appropriate. That's interesting stuff, because what it shows, unless I'm mistaken, is that it's eternal. It just,
I mean, it,
I don't know if you agree with that, Jonathan? I mean, you're on top of
you're
the past, in a sense.
Yeah, I mean, so like...
Jonathan is a young person.
Yeah.
No, but he's the youngest person at the table, but at the same time, he's most knowledgeable about the past from what was said today.
Mm.
Yeah. The 90s are in. I got this off Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. I taught a class at Parsons, a second semester freshman programming class for like fine arts students, and not one of them knew what a file was. I had to explain it, and that was my fault for just assuming that, right? And that didn't mean that what they were learning in the class, which was essentially older knowledge, and might be arcane knowledge, because by the time they get out of the school, it's just gonna, more than half of what I taught is just gonna be useless. It didn't mean that they like threw out their ideas of like what was interesting and what wasn't, right? So if you bring someone in who's 15 years old and you give them a Nintendo controller and you tell them to play a Nintendo game, the first level joke is they're going to stare at the screen and not press a button, and they're not going to move Mario, and they're going to be like, what the hell? Because they're so used to newer games telling you every single thing you can do as an instruction device, like the instruction booklet is just not a thing that they know about. And then they'll play it, and then they'll either enjoy it or they won't. And there's a project of... you can go on YouTube and you can see what do kids think of blank, right? And it's this series where they introduce objects that are just before their time and you get reactions. And the reactions for the Commodore and the reactions for like all these devices are super basic, like where's the on button or touching the screen because it's not a touch screen. But I do think the nostalgia factor is a strong factor in making these like, oh, these are so great. Like if you And by experiencing it upstairs, you'll realize the discontinuity between your memory, your experience, and what it's actually like. And there's a reason that the newer machines, yeah, the rhetoric of you need to buy every year might be a little too much in one direction, but the fact of the matter of, like, are there deeper and more engaging interactions that have been brought about by newer technologies, and, like, is this a progress that has enabled people to do things that they couldn't before, is definitely true. Like, I'm gonna go home and buy a Minitel because the keyboard is just so, like, there's something about the device that I love. But I bet if I was running the software on that, I'll hang out for like 20 minutes, I'll tweet about it, be like, this is so cool. And then I might not ever touch it again because, you know, what we can do with these devices are more compelling. So.
Well, I was wondering about that question. I mean, it seems like, yes, we recycle so much cultural material and never-ending cycles of nostalgia and whatever, and yet, outside of this discussion, I have not seen an equivalent fetish for old computers or for old interfaces. I mean,
yeah.
You're obviously closer to that community, but I mean, and so, you know, it makes me wonder, is it like, is there something inherent in these things that is not like these other cultural artifacts that is resistant to that kind of recycling? Or is it just that it's so hard to put these things in front of people that it's just like nobody's seen it enough to even know that it's a thing? You know, it's like, well, I've seen bell-bottom jeans, so
right. Sure.
But I can't remember the last time I saw, you know, a first-generation Apple interface, and, right. You know.
Right. What are you recycling, right? Like, if you're recycling content, what's nostalgia is new T-shirts with old, like, aesthetics or whatever I'm going to misuse that word in this room, but because I have no training, but like, you know, you're recycling the visual and auditory culture. There's always movements of the hippest new music that's like, oh, it's 90s elevator music, man. That's what I make. It's called vaporwave, right? Like, it's not.
Wait,
yes,
is that?
Yes. And there's a thing called sea punk where you like pretend you're a dolphin in the sea. No joke. Like, so it's all this like it's a reappropriation of that stuff that the nostalgia is carrying over. But what are you gonna do with a keyboard? I know a few programmers who have a Model M keyboard with a bunch of adapters because they want to use the old keyboard, and that's the extent I've seen of reimagining old interfaces. That, and there is a movement of people using feature phones, which I think is like totally legitimate. Hey, I actually like the way this works better, and having experienced the new and the old, this works for these things much better for me.
Mm-hmm. But there's sort of a knowledge barrier as well, right? Like, if you're going to actually use a Commodore 64, you might need to know something first, whereas if you just put on some bell bottoms, then you just need to know how to put on pants.
Exactly.
Well, but I was, the other example I was going to use was, I mean, the Pac-Man Google Apps, or Google Maps thing,
yeah.
You know, which feels more like, that feels like the equivalent of putting an old Mountain Dew logo on a current T-shirt, you know, like here's something that used to be cool, sort of, kind of appropriated into a more modern interface.
And you can go to Barcade
but
and play old games.
There's
more.
But think about kids, right? So one of the great things that, you know, you have a little kid, you have a little son. I don't know if anybody else here has kids on the panel. Several in the audience do, right? You get your kid, and it's like, great, now I get to buy toys for them, and you relive, you know, like, you get Lego, you introduce them to whatever it is, Legos, dolls, you know, your little kitchen set that you love, there's a whole series. If you love Tonka trucks, there's a really good chance you're
going to
bring them. my niece, you know, my cousin
people's personalities
action.
Come
people
out in the gifts they get for children.
Figures,
yeah.
Figures, and so their kids have all these, like, you know, little Hulk action figures. Star Wars. They can name all the characters in Star Wars. The question is, you know, and they look forward to, adults look forward to, or used to, playing with, you know, little car racing sets and so forth. What I've really wondered is, will they be, people say, oh,
I'm going to show you what Daddy played with, the Commodore 64, and, you know, taking you back to that game. Like, will you relive your childhood or communicate some of that, you know, cultural knowledge with your kid? Or is there, is that a shift in childhood experiences? Or,
you know, also, I think that to bring it back to audience or academic levels, you know, there's also something about the way that different intellectual systems consider themselves. I mean, the style and aesthetics model doesn't map onto the technology model, because style has always been forwardly referential to the past. You know, like, people create new style based on bell bottoms because there's a history of that happening historically. Going all the way back in the history of fashion and clothing and design. And I think because the forms and the technologies and the fabrics have not altered so dramatically over time. I mean, you could go down to the street and look at the first three floors of the building and you could argue with me. But and I think one thing about the kind of, the, and this goes back to the MIT example, the mindset of technology, the mindset of engineering is a positivist progressivism, you know, that you stated a little bit, Jonathan, you know, that, like, the next thing's better, so why would I go back to the other thing? And that's just the way those things move forward. Like, oh, I have the new thing, I'm not going to go back to the thing, that's just nostalgia. It's just nostalgia. It's just aesthetics. It's not functional. It's not practical. And so when it's like the entire epistemology of that realm, it doesn't have that kind of self-referential, historical, basis to go back on regularly. Which is embedded in aesthetic study, which is embedded in art history, embedded in fashion. You know, that's one great thing about the BGC is we bring all these things together, we stir them in the pot, and it's like, okay, now I see why the history of design is different from the history of art history, which is different from the history of the kind of mature culture of technology. Because it's the intellectual mindsets that go into the creation of those objects. And these have moved so fast, so quickly, and the functionality is so starkly different. You know, it's like going from that to the Commodore is like, you are crazy, right? Mm-hmm. The big joke is people being able to get, like, Firefox running on a Commodore 64, and, like, it's all text, and, like, it's broken. And it's just an achievement of nostalgia. It really isn't something you'd functionally use. And so that's a question, right? That's kind of what the gallery is talking about, too, is, like, how do we feel about that? You know, how do we feel about that being part of our culture? And also the kind of the techno culture of the United States being so reliant on that that recent history. So that's where there are those clashes to that. And I don't know if there's a functional, like, I don't know if my son and I will play Nintendo someday together. I have Nintendo controllers. You can plug in a USB and play on an emulator on a computer. So that's like kind of it'll work. But he'll probably be bored out of his mind. And then I'll feel bad for hurting my son's hands with the controllers. So, the Andrew and the Marianne.
Well, I was interested actually in something Deborah said earlier at lunch, just talking about how technology is one of those things that in 100 years from now we may have so few remnants of actually what it was, like what these computers actually were, that to be able to collect them or to be able to understand them basically would take, you know, taking Jonathan out of his grave or whatever. And it's like there's nothing. Sorry.
How far in the future?
200 years. 200 years.
200 years. Yeah.
Robot bodies by next decade.
I'm a cyborg, so.
But I'm interested, kind of more specifically, thinking about what it is that you actually, knowing this, like, what is it actually as a museum or as an institution, like, how do you actually capture that, as much of this information as possible? How do we collect it? I know some museums, you know, the Cooper Hewitt, they collect some apps, but then they collect the code for the app. But is that, like, how do we start to kind of unravel, like, what do you take when you're collecting a Commodore 64? Like, you can collect three of the physical devices, but what does that mean beyond understanding, like, what the actual object is? And is it oral histories? Is it the documentation that comes with the computer? Is it the box? Is it the discs? I mean, what are those things? I'm just curious if maybe Deborah or whomever else might want to speak to, like, how do we start to even tackle that problem? Because they are such a part of our 21st century way of living.
It
It's a really easy question to ask. It's a really hard thing, really hard thing to actually do. The first task is you have to decide as a museum what you want to collect. Because software and computing, for that matter, are ubiquitous. I mean, it's not just this or this.
Which version? Which year?
You know, it's the stuff that goes into that. It's the garage door opener. It's the all the coding examples that the students at MIT do in our class or in your class. It's just pervasive. So we've privileged a small number of kinds of devices. So this show, intentionally, because you know your space and time and resources,
yeah,
focuses on a very interesting subset of devices. But for example, gambling,
yeah,
isn't there at all, and that's like a monumentally huge field of personal interface. There's no ATM machine, even though you know all of us use that kind of device. So task number one is to figure out what you're gonna collect. Task number two is, yes, the hardware is important, and you kind of have to decide institutionally where your resources lie. So I come out of the aerospace world before coming to MIT, and so the National Air and Space Museum, where I first worked, is not a flying museum. You know, it doesn't fly its airplanes. A few of them have flown in to Dulles, and that's it. You know, and they put it now into Udvar-Hazy. I think the SR-71 set its last world record flying in to then have its engines turned off to go into the museum. But the Confederate Air Force Museum or the old Rhinebeck aerodrome up the river here, they're flying museums. So you have to decide that, because the kinds of expertise associated with the two are different. And that means, therefore, the kind of materials you want to have are different. So technology can be artifacts. It can then be processes. So you have to try and gather some information about the processes. But again, if you're an artifact-only museum, what you gather may vary, because you want it to help support the objectives of keeping the thing from disintegrating, in front of you. The community matters. So people right now, people like to hear human stories, and there's all the techniques of oral history and so forth. You try to gather that. There's astonishingly little and very poor quality written materials.
Except for my book.
Yes. Yeah. Well, but I mean, in terms
available
of...
Available for sale.
I think I forgot I was shared with you. Is that, you know, when they built the Whirlwind computer at MIT, the first real-time digital computer, it came out of a culture that was very clear on documenting and how do you keep the team informed. So they have twice weekly memos explaining what every group did, you know. And so you have that, and then whenever you did anything big, you had to write that down. And you know, so the files that are available are astonishing. Like, you can really tell the story of Whirlwind in a way that gets into the head, gets into empathy. I mean, that's possible. But Google app inventor that Hal Abelson, or Scratch that Mitch Resnick develops, there's like virtually nothing on Scratch, and yet that's pervasive globally in terms of kids learning how to program. It's a really interesting program, but very little. So you know, you try to gather as much resources, but sometimes they're just isn't. So those are there, and then the money, that your institution, like, I don't live in
you know, having the people available to do things. New York is a great place. So MIT is a great place. We've got a lot of smart computer people, but they don't have much free time to do museum stuff. Here, we've got all these big museums that have underwritten amazing stuff so that people like Jonathan and others around here have had some real, you know, have built a really interesting skill set. We probably are going to have to, as a museum, invent a training program for this kind of work. I mean, invent a kind of curatorship and how do you train someone to do that? So we're going to have to actually invent, that's the other step, is invent a class of people who just are not just knowledgeable about it, like baseball, people that are just knowledgeable about, you know, statistics and baseball, but actually can play the game. So those are some of the challenges, but then the materials themselves disintegrate.
They're awful.
I mean, most of them will, there's a good chance many of them just won't be around a century from now. Some of the materials are only warrantied for 10 years. Mylar tape. So anyway, I could go on and on, but you can, others might be able to add.
I think the thing is that this is, it's a question that actually has implications across lots of different museums. I mean, it's one that comes up in art museums as well, whether it's the collecting of artwork that is created in a digital environment, or even, you know, kind of looking at the museum where I worked before, Cleveland, we did a reinstallation and put out a Nunjum Pike piece that involved
somebody here knows what that's
yes.
about.
So it involved a sculpture of a Buddha with a video camera that was taping it or recording it, and it was going out through a television, like a big old not flat screen television, right? And the stuff that they had to go through, and this is not that many years ago, in order to get a television that was appropriate for the specs that were laid out by the artist, was, you know, kind of ridiculous. And when they bought as many, they like went to all these thrift stores and basically bought as many TVs as they could. And the thing is that eventually those are going to wear out, and then that piece can't be shown anymore because he's dead. You can't go back to him and say, hey, is it okay if I swap this out for a flat screen? So, you know, it's sort of an ongoing problem, even kind of beyond when what you're collecting is technology. It's where technology intersects with everything else as well.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely true. And I mean, one of the things in acquiring those kinds of works, like one of the first things you have to do is try and get the creator of the work while he or she is still alive and basically address what seem like very fundamental questions, like, for you, what is this work?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And you know, when I was at the Denver Art Museum, a big part of our accessioning process was just a series of questions like that. You know, where I said, like, is the hardware part of the work? Is the hardware not part of the work? Like, it, you know, is the sort of aesthetic thing that you're putting forward the important part? And is that what we're preserving, or are we actually also preserving the hardware? Because, you know, if you don't do that, then you get into situations like, you know, like the Nanjing Pipe Estate is somewhat notorious for being very difficult to deal with on the assembly. It's like, no, you have to use the technology.
Oh, if you only knew our current.
Yeah, I would use the word very.
Just in case they're watching, you know, let's be nice. But so I mean, that's a big part of it. But I think, you know, also, you know, to what Deborah was saying, I think. One thing is we've sort of like offloaded all of this on sort of general technology people in museums right now. We haven't yet really established, like, what is the curatorial impulse for this sort of work look like? Like, when I think about collecting oral histories and things like that, that feels very much to me like the curatorial side. Mm-hmm. You know, whereas like the work that Jonathan is doing, I think, you know, rightly so, is that's conservation. Like, how do we keep these working and useful? There's a really dire need for training programs to train both these conservators and these curators. And actually, I will point to the most probably interesting and effective one here in the United States,
or here in New York rather, which is what Dina Engel is doing at NYU. I wish she was here. It'd be fun to hear from her on this. But doing software conservation, and it's really important work and something that I hope turns into a bigger program. Joe, I'm sorry, you've had your hand up the whole time I've been talking.
And then I just have last question, we're going to wrap up.
I was actually going to answer your question in the context of what Deborah and Jonathan talked about, which is that software and hardware are not produced in isolation. Mm-hmm. It's all culturally embedded and it's all politically embedded. So who is using it? For what? What was it marketed and sold for? Who adopted it for something else? That's a piece of the software and the hardware. And I don't come from the museum world, so I don't know how you grab all that. But that's all of a piece. I don't think you can.
I mean, I think that's you keep the stuff, and then you hope you have the curators who can keep that context alive as the devices, because it's hard to not overdetermine that context. And be too prescriptive by writing stuff along, like...
Maybe those people aren't called curators.
Well, that's a...
Maybe about the people at MIS are doing, for example.
At MIS?
At MEL, Institute for Technology and mm-hmm. Humanities. Mm-hmm. I mean, they have the problem with regard to digital literature, and that's exactly the same issue. Can you deal with digital literature that's written on screens, and how do you preserve it?
I mean, I guess the flip side, and we have to get going, because we need to clean the room out, is that... The challenge is also to not get too apoplectically anxious about this, and that like these are also problems that have existed with every piece of material, which is also exhausted over time. Like nothing lasts forever in any state, and so I think that's an interesting challenge is like how do we meet like the, because one problem about the digital is that there's this myth of infinite copies to preserve. Like we've been taught that we can save everything just by being safe. And so the real challenge is how do you build the systems of conservation that understand intelligently what a museum can actually accomplish? Because, and I think you're right, Deborah, is it the watch, like, is it the key fob? Like, that key fob might be really important, you know? Or is it the big branded corporate computer? Or like, and that those are, it's a fun time to be able to have those conversations. And a lot of digital realms, you know, in the digital humanities, everywhere, like they launch towards this anxiety based on this the ability to save everything and how we can kind of have the kind of thoughtful conversations and this, I think that places like the states also, like, they're too hard and the anxiety seeps into people both over saving and under saving and where that middle ground is will be interesting. And also, I think we're at a point where we're creating more than we've ever created. And we're also producing more stuff. Because it's like, it's all the Internet of Things is about to come upon us. Like, in every little single thing, like, which part of that do we save, you know? So that's an interesting challenge. And that's, I know, you know, the great thing about the show is that it was a room. What can you fit in a room? And it's great to have those artificial restraints and sometimes that teaches you lessons a lot, you know. So just the last thing is that, like, I had to pick iPhone or iPad. It's like, well, the iPad replaced a computer as well the iPhone did, so I'll make my curatorial choice based on that. But at the same time, we needed this wall of mobile devices because there's clearly all this stuff going on. So you kind of end up in real situations which allow you to make real decisions, and that's where we're going to go. And it's about keeping a level of acute, intelligent awareness without getting kind of blown away by this avalanche of stuff and content and kind of anxious presence that we feel about all of these things. So I wish we could keep talking, but I was told by this fabulous little note that we need to get out earlier than I thought. I went over anyway. but there's more coffee reception outside, so if you have questions, please ask us out there as well. Thank you very much. You're a great audience. Tomorrow, and if you can't come back tomorrow, make sure you come and see the show down the street and buy many books.